course, people. What time is it here? It's 10 o'clock, I think. I looked down. I was reviewing my comments on my gun channel. I turned off my computer last night, so when you turn it down and shut it down, I normally have it on all the time and it's uploading or whatever, but man, I shut it down last night, so I had to come in this morning, turn on the power, let it boot, then it gave me all the new warnings, Windows 11, whatever, so it took me a minute to get logged in. Switzerland, howdy. Land of food, great horses, India. Sunflower State, Kansas. Is that the Sunflower State? I didn't know that. Hey, I got a pesky citizen here. That's what I call victims of government on my gun channel, for those that don't know that. Over here, I call stupid humans when they do something with a horse, but on the other one. Massachusetts. Let's see. Poland. That's a good looking horsey. Hey, hey. I have no idea what I'm talking about today. I was running around this morning. I just got back from the bank. I had to feed the horses. Been working on the next video is going to come out on this horse trailer. I went out there to freaking just wash the roof on the horse trailer, and it turned into 14 projects. So I did a video on it. It's about 30 minutes. Finally uploaded. I'll probably make it public tomorrow. But, here we go. I'm in a bad mood. Here we go. It's already starting. I'm in a bad mood. Damn it. Damn. Thought I was going to be in a good mood. Now I'm in a damn grouchy mood. Shit. Palm Blade, Florida. Upstate New York. Ohio. Lee. Lee caught the COVID. She got the big C. That's not good. She left a message or a comment on my other video saying, guess who tested positive? And I don't know if she got the vaxxer. Are you one of those crazy conspiracy non-vaxxers, or did you submit and say, yes, government, I believe you, and took the vax? Regardless, she's got the COVID. Still alive. She said she'd be watching today from her bed. So are you in bed? Remember when you open a fortune cookie, you're supposed to always add in bed. So whatever the fortune cookie says, you always put in bed. You will have a wonderful, exciting life in bed. Iceland, Oklahoma. I was cussing out some Oklahoma drivers this morning, driving back from the post office. Got to go freaking 50 in the freaking 70 lane in the fast lane. And then look at me like, why am I passing you? Because you're in the freaking fast lane, you big dumbass, driving in Texas like you're in Oklahoma. Uh-oh, I'm sorry. I was in a grouchy mood. Oh, it was so nice. The lady was just driving in the fast lane, slowing up traffic. And I passed her and waved and said good morning. I was in such a good mood. It was so nice. Freaking whatever. Uh-oh, lays in bed. Lay, good on you. What did she do that's good? She's in bed? Good on her? Oh, I'm vaxxed. I told you I need to see a mom. Oh, I forgot. Sorry. So many people tell me so many reasons for what they do. I can't remember everybody. So evidently, you told me, not that I remember, sorry, that you had to get vaxxed to see your mom. But so now you're vaxxed, and now you have COVID. But I thought if you got COVID, if you got vaccine, you didn't need to wear a mask, and you weren't. Oh, but they changed that. Now you can get it and you can pass it on. You just needed to get the vax that was experimental, that now they're making everybody get it, that they're blaming everybody who didn't get the vax, that there's a big outsurge. Yet we have 10,000 people from Haiti who have 1% vaccinated in their country, and they're across the border in Texas. But it's the people that didn't get the vax's fault that we're in problems. Okay, I got it. Make sure we clear that up for you people who aren't. Is everybody being nice to Lee? Nobody's being mean? Oh, I forgot. I'm on my horsey channel. I'm on my gun channel. My gun channel, they be dogging her. Why did you get the vax? Why did... Netherlands. Aw. Jen's giving out hugs. Aw. Everybody give a self hug for Lee. Oh, we got a little self hug. Oh, I gotta give my little horsies a hug. Oh. All right. Now we got the hugs and crap out. All I feel good shit. Here we go. Let's get down to freaking business. Where are we at? The vax is COVID. All right. I got some people here. I'll tell you, man, it's getting a pain in the ass to explain to everybody why I don't want to go out. I mean, look, it's nice to meet some of yours. And when they come, I would go meet them and have a drink, or we'd have coffee or something. And it was kind of cool. But I just don't want to get out. I didn't get the vax. I don't want to get the vax. And I don't want to come in contact with people. But it seems like every time somebody says, hey, man, I'm coming through Texas. Where can we meet? It's like, man, I'm not meeting people right now. And then I got other buddies calling me, yo, man, you want to go for my buddy this morning, go on a car ride? And I'm like, no. And he texts me back. I don't know what let me see what he texts. Because I was thinking he's going to give me shit for not wanting to. Let's see what Charlie said. Oh, he just said, did you get sick? No, I'm not sick. So he said, hey, man, bikes, let's go for coffee. I said, no, man, I'm on lockdown. I didn't get the jab, and I don't want to come in contact with people. I said, have a good day, and I got to do my live at 10. So, but, you know, some people are like, okay, that's cool. Other people, you got to justify why you don't want to meet them. And then you got to get health advice from them on how you shouldn't let the disease scare you, and how you shouldn't let it change you, and how, you know, I'm not getting a vax, but I do this, and you should do this. And so it becomes this big freaking, like, argument every time I say, look, I'm on self-lockdown. I don't want to deal with people. I don't want to get out there. I don't want to get exposed. I don't want to get sick. I'm just staying away from people. Can I just do that without having to explain my entire life or get life advice from everybody that feels they know best and that I shouldn't be doing what I'm doing? It gets so freaking old. Oh, I forgot I'm in a bad mood. Rick's in a bad mood. Shut up, you freaking crybabies. You're going to get me in a bad mood. All right, where are we at here? Yeah, Lee, how's that vax working out for you? So, Lee, let me get this straight, Lee. She got the vax so she can see her mom, and now she's got COVID so she can't see her mom. How'd that shit work out? How does that work, people? All right, never mind. Here we go. I'm not trying to dog you. I really don't want to give people shit for what they choose. I want everybody to have free choice and make their choice and not get shit about it. But I want to be able to make my choice and not get shit about it either. I mean, if I even talk about the vaccine or say, hey, they got this, or I put out any information, I'm immediately, why are you buying into it? Why are you being fooled? Why are you being a sucker? Why are you letting them get to you? Why? And I'm like, oh, my freaking God. Dealing with freaking people who have no accountability, fake names, fake accounts, can just come into your life on the internet. Suddenly, it's just, ugh. I freaking hate most people. I know. I'm right there with you. I'm kind of like, look, I was on lockdown before COVID even existed. I didn't like to go out. I mean, I didn't mind going out and having dinner or eating or meeting a buddy for coffee or something like that. But I'm not this man of the world. I want to go flying at a freaking airport. I want to come in contact with thousands of people. I'm going to go drive. I wasn't that guy before COVID. So now that COVID's here, I'm just a little bit more like, you know what? It just ain't worth the freaking risk and the hassle. I don't want to shake your hand. People want to come up and shout. I don't want to freaking shake your hand. I don't want a knuckle bump. I don't want a hug. Just leave me the fuck alone. I'm happy talking to you on the internet. Okay. Oh, geez. Oh, now I'm nuts. Damn. First I was in a bad mood. Now I'm nuts. Where's Pat? Pat, Mr. I don't want to catch COVID and I don't want to get the vaccine. He's driving across freaking country, visiting people, going up to Massachusetts, New York, somewhere to visit his buddy, coming in contact. And I'm like, dude, you know, every time you contact somebody, you are contacting everybody they contacted for the last week. Because it can take 7 days for the virus to manipulate, 7 to 10 days before you actually start showing signs or have the virus. So you could be passing on. So you're putting your trust in everybody that they've contacted that you have no idea whether they wash their hands, whether they shake hands or whatever. And I said, for every person you do that, you multiply your risk of doing it. I mean, how do you think there's a big epidemic right now? people are running around shaking hands and saying, oh, screw COVID. It ain't nothing and I don't care. And I mean, who's in the hospital? But buddy Bob, his mom and dad both got COVID, both got the vaccine. His dad was home for a few days. His mom's still in the freaking hospital. They moved her to another hospital. She's 80 years old and she's been in there for freaking like 4 or 5 weeks now. So, you know, the more I hear all this bullshit, I don't believe anything the government says. I don't believe anything the media says. You know what? I'm going to make my own damn decision because I don't have enough information to make maybe an educated decision. So I'm going to do what I'm going to do. So get off my back, you freaking crazy internet stalking know-it-alls. Rick's nuts this morning. Okay, we already established that. You need to talk to Lester. I haven't talked to Lester since the big donkey attack. That was a great freaking video. I made a comment on one of the donkeys. I said, shit, if we can stick some ostrich feathers on that donkey, we can call him Carletta. Instead of Carl, because Carl's his male one, we can call the donkey that attacked him Carletta and put some ostrich feathers on her. Jamie ought to get a freaking fake ostrich feather or head or something, dress the donkey up, take a big blow-up picture, go and get it blown up to a big poster of this freaking donkey head with the mouth open and there's ostrich feathers all around it. And then when Lester's sleeping, hang that shit up and go in there with a camera and wake his ass up. He would wake up, see that donkey with ostrich feathers, shit the bed, roll on the floor. That would be a great video. Oh, shit. Wait a minute. I'm supposed to be in a bad mood. And the freaking people talk about COVID. Yeah, Rick's in a bad mood. I forgot. I can't be laughing. Freaking crazy people telling me what kind of mood I'm in, what I fucking ate, what my shit looks like, whether it should float or sink. Rick, if your shit is floating, then you're not eating a good, healthy diet. And if it's sinking, that means you, whatever, people. Quit giving freaking advice. Jesus Christ. That donkey video was freaking hilarious. Poor Lester was out there playing Born Free Reunion. Oh, it's so cute. All right. So on my gun channel, I went through all my pictures. And there was a lot of horsey pictures that I was either going to talk about or do something. So I'm going to do that again. Because I had a whole bunch of horse. Matter of fact, I got complaints because there was too much horse shit and I was showing it on my gun life. So now I'm going to get shit from my horse people because I'm showing shit that ain't horses. You know, when you have a channel, you can't do anything right. People come here and will watch you, but they know that you can't do anything right and they got to tell you everything you've done wrong. So let me get to the front of this photos here. So these are all the damn pictures on my desktop that I need to either add to my gun website or to my horse website. So there's different things, and I'm not going to go over and bore you on most stuff. That was the spider video where the spider had a nice cricket. Look at that big old cricket. That little spider hooked it up. I kind of messed up the other day. You're going to see it. I don't know what video I put it in. It might have been in a horse trailer. So I found a little bitty one of these spiders over by where I was cleaning my horse trailer. And because I was washing it and putting all kind of chemicals, I said, I better move you because you're going to end up dying. So I put them on a shovel and I brought them over to this one thinking they could share a web. It didn't work out so well. So you may not want to watch that video. let's see here. Here was a picture that I need to add to my website. In case none of y'all have ever seen it, this is how they used to transport. This was the old ambulance back in the day. So this is what it looked like. Horsey carrying two people on a side. And again, when I talk about saddles or bareback, you notice they didn't put a piece of wood right on his back so he would be carrying all this weight on one spot. They've got like a hard shell that goes around. They have a thick pad here. And that is spreading this weight over a larger part of the horse's body. If you just put this wood with a pad or a saddle that's very small, as wide as the wood, and you put that on a horse's back, it would hurt the horse a buck and it would probably cause damage because this is a lot of weight. But when you distribute that weight over a larger area, not so bad. So that's how they used to transport people. I wanted to add that to my website. Hang on, let me go. Morning, Vicky. Rick, that's me on the pick. What? What pick? That's me on the pick. What? Oh, the spider one? Shit. I don't talk much about COVID anymore. I had so much personal lice and so much crap. I don't really have an opinion anymore. I'm just sick of it. I am too. I don't want to talk about it either. Give Rick a like. Thank you. Unless you think I'm in a bad mood, then give me a thumbs down. Let's see. Let's use the thumbs up and thumbs down as that whether Rick's in a bad mood or a good mood. So then you can change it throughout. Every time I say something you don't like, you can click the down. And then if I say something you like and I'm happy, you can go back and click the up. And then you'll feel in control of my life somehow. Freaking crazy people. That damn Spider-Man. I was having a hard time speeding him. So I figured out a good way to feed him is I've got that little fly swatter that it's not a fly swatter that you kill him with. It's got little wires and you press a button and it shocks him. It zaps him. So it's a bug zapper fly swatter. Well, if I bug zap one of those freaking dirt daubers that I hate because they're building dirt daubers all over everywhere and are always coming over the water, then I leave for the rabbit and the cat. So now I learned that if I go over there with that little shocker and I zap them, they stick to the thing. So I zap them, they stick to it. Then I bring them over to the nest and then they'll like almost climb up on the nest. And then she's on top of them. Boom. So she's eating my dirt daubers, which I hate, and she's wrapping them up. And I'm bringing them to her. So we've got it worked out now to where we're mutually thing. So this was in my doctor's office, a picture, and I took a picture of it. I don't know where I was going to put it or what. I just thought it was pretty amazing when they did a, is this an MRI or, yeah, MRI on a person. So this is how large a person was. And then when you look at their body frame, this is how small their body frame is. Kind of amazing. Because, you know, when you see a body and you see them large, you kind of think maybe their bones get bigger or denser to carry and everything's growing except, you know, you just don't think that that's just fat growing around a skeleton body. You don't see it or think of it in that way. And when I saw this picture, I was like, wow. All right. So that was that picture. That's just how cops are freaking. So that was a sunrise picture that I took one morning. I don't know where the horses are at, but I just snapped it because I thought it was a pretty nice picture in the morning. That little bush right there, everybody says that's a nest. That is freaking mistletoe. And it's a pain in the butt. And I usually cut it off, but I haven't got my tall ladder out there to cut that off. It's still there. I need to cut it off. And then I spray it with bleach and water. And it keeps it from growing back for a couple years. Because it gets into the roots and vines. It'll eventually kill your tree. But anyway, so that picture was there. I need to add this to my horsey site because I thought it was kind of funny. Way back in the early days when people got around in horses and cabs, you still had crazy ass women that knew everything that still thought it was a good idea to jump in front of a freaking horse. So if people think this may be a new thing and I'm just picking on women now, here it is. Way back before I was picking on women, women were jumping in front of freaking horses. And there's the proof. Rick, that's not fair. You just, all right, whatever. I'm in a bad mood. All right, this is all gun stuff. Gun stuff, cop parking in a handicap, electrical stuff. That's me and my dog, Herky. We just won first place in some competition. I can't. AFLC, I think, whatever. That was the video I ended up taking down. Remember those when I did this video? This is the one that, who's the guy that everybody likes? Warwick. So Warwick did a video on his girl and made her into the victim and said how nice she was and it wasn't her fault. Kind of like blame the horse. And then when I did a reaction video saying, look, I don't think it's a horse's fault. I think she taught it to do this. She didn't know it was showing. She's heavy-handed. So I did a video on that, and then he called me and said, hey, she shared a video with me, and she really didn't want it out there. And basically, she only wanted me to do it because she knew I was going to be nice to her and whatever. So I ended up taking the video down. But that picture is still there. I don't even need it. I mean, I might as well delete it, but whatever. Okay, so that picture's gone. So this is the boys hanging out one morning. I don't know what. I just saw the donkey the other day. His halter is off now. But then I saw Belle and her halter's back on. Let's see. Her halter was on here. Then they took it off. And then this yesterday, I saw her. She's got a pretty blue halter. Oh, it's so cute. She's got a blue halter on now. So, and look, I don't give a shit if people keep halters on their horses. It's their horses, people. I'm just telling you it's dangerous. And it shows that you're not spending time and you can't catch your horse unless you leave a halter on it. Really, you can catch a horse. You just don't want to take time, and it takes more time, and it's easier to leave the halter on. So people are like, well, why do people do that if they know it's dangerous, Rick? Well, look, they obviously don't care enough to take time to catch their horse and to learn how to catch their horse. So why would they care if they left a halter on, a horse got killed or hurt? So, I mean, you know, trying to change people's mind or tell them why this is a bad idea. I mean, you can't believe the number of people that come here and complain every time I show a horse with a halter on and go, look, that's a bad idea. I got halters of dead horses hung on a fence where it choked and they killed themselves. I got pictures of a horse that killed himself in a stall because he had a freaking halter on. They came in fine in the morning and everybody cried and felt sorry for the poor woman and she loved it and all this other shit. And then I'm a bad guy because I go, it's bullshit. She didn't love him. She loved him. She learned how to catch her damn horse and she wouldn't leave a halter on that could kill him. But anyway, I digress. Rick's in a bad mood. Everybody go downvote my video now. Rick's in a bad mood. That was that, I went to that damn rescue and I was going to work. This is a round pen with 3 feet of freaking shit. And I was going to help train some Mustangs so they find homes. And it was a freaking mess and I didn't go back. And of course I got hate and said I was a bad guy because I could help them and I abandoned them. And just because there was shit and I didn't want to get dirty, it was my fault and I'm a mean guy. And it's the same thing. You try to help people do something, somebody will find a way to make it negative and blame you. And so anyway, I don't know what the hell this picture is. Oh, that's a movie. That's Mr. T and his girlfriend. I have not posted this video yet because I haven't watched it. But I took this video before Mr. T died, like a couple days before. And it's still on my desktop. So I need to edit that and do it. I think I got 2 or 3 videos of him that I never posted right before he died. And whenever I feel like I can just sit through them, I will. This is just, this is actually a weather watch movie that I did. And I thought this little tornado was going to happen right here. I was like, ooh, this thing might develop into a little tornado. And then it kind of petered out and went away. I was like going to be a rock star for a few days if I made that. Been like, what do they call that? What's that thing is it rock star? It's something they call, I think it's kind of a black thing. That it's mainly black people. And when they say that you do something, you're going to get on this one website and be, I thought it was Rockstar. I can't remember what it is. Go to comments. Maybe somebody can, let's see. Not keen on your spider. Oh, poor little guys out there trying to make a living. Neurotic. Shoot flies with salt. Yeah, I'm not, I got criticized for taking the halter off my horse when I first got it because the person that had him before me said he was impossible to catch. Well, of course. I mean, it's your horse and you can't even take the halter off. I used to really think it was like the horse dominated, but the more this COVID and everything's going on, it's just like everybody wants to tell everyone else how to live their life. And this is this freaking, you know, living on the government tit all the time, grave, you know, from cradle to grave, the government wants you dependent on them and they want to get in and regulate and tell you what's good and what's bad, what you shouldn't do. And pretty soon it's just normal. And people then start saying, well, the government says you do it, then you should do it. And if you don't do it, then you're not a good guy. And I got to help you. And I got to help the government because I believe the government. And it's just everybody's in everybody's business 24/7. Oh, now Mr. Grumpy Pants. All righty. That bird in the distance. What bird? Spa, they changed the design. Swatters. Grouchy Pants. Wow. I must be in a really bad mood today. You know what? If I'm in that bad a mood, we have 2 choices. I can just stop the fucking live and you people can go tell everybody else how grumpy they are. Or you can just fucking leave. How about that? Damn, Rick's in a grumpy mood. No, I just don't want to hear this bullshit every time I look at the comments. Some motherfucker telling me. The next person that tells me I'm grumpy is getting blocked out of the freaking video. How about that? Then I'll prove you're right. You know what? That's the let's take the grumpy test challenge. If you say Rick's grumpy, you get blocked. And then we'll prove he's grumpy. Okay, we'll fix that shit right fucking now. How about that? Emily Dale's been trampled to death by a horse in 1913. There was some woman that jumped in front of a freaking horse in shit, 2002. Thought it was a good idea to run horse that he wanted to help abuse. Look, people, I spend a lot of freaking time doing these lives, and afterwards I have to edit the shit. Then I have to put the things. And if you guys don't want to listen to me or don't want to be here, then fucking leave. I don't want to hear your fucking bullshit. I just said I don't want to hear people's shit, and now I got comments left and right about how I'm fucking grumpy. I just don't need to fucking do this shit. You people think you're doing me a favor by coming here and telling me that I'm fucking grumpy, because obviously I don't fucking have a life and I don't know when I'm fucking grumpy. I don't need your fucking bullshit. Let's see if I got to block anybody. Oh, good morning, Rick. Thank you, Mary. Good morning. We have toxic positivity. thanks, JB. Too many F-bombs for my kids. You know what? Let me fix that. You're fucking blocked. Now, you and your kids can go elsewhere. How about that? Anybody else? Come on, people. Come on down. It's Rick Block Day. I'm hungover today. I'm not hungover. It's almost evening. Hello from Wisconsin. Howdy. All right, let me get back these damn pictures. That's the horsey hoof that shows up and down. I think I already have those on my website. I probably can delete both of those and start cleaning up my desktop. Delete. All right. That's Buddy Boy. That's when he was dark or something. I want to get a good picture of him after he slicked. Oh, no. That was the picture when his hair got caught in his pee-pee. Remember that? Oh, I'm sorry. There might be children watching. I can't say pee-pee. Somebody's going to get offended and come here and tell me, he said pee-pee and my kids can't hear it. Now I have to leave because Rick has to talk exactly perfect for my kids, because that's why I come to the show, so he can talk perfect for my kids. Are you fucking kidding me? Good morning from Bagels. Is that like a place you get coffee? Great day, Rick. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. How are the critters today? They're good today. Buddy and I started saying Mr. T. Buddy and Ransom shared a pile of hay. I put it down. There was no fighting. They walked over and I left. I expected them to be a little fighting. I kind of watched them. I hit around a corner. No fighting. So they're finally getting to where I can kind of feed them in one pile and there's no issues. So, and if you remember, that was a big issue when I first got them. Buddy wouldn't let him. And there was this all kind of problems and a pain in the butt. And everybody's like, you know, and then I got the hate from the people coming here telling me I'm making them compete from food. The expert email that told me I was making them compete and it was my fault and I should never feed them together and they should have their own space. And well, now they're eating together. So now I'm doing more bad work by letting them eat together. New Hampshire. Let's see. That was some picture of some idiot. And I hate to say it, but I think it was a woman that was filling up gas in a freaking plastic bags and putting them in her trunk. This isn't a good idea, people. Okay, I know it seems like somebody's going to go, that's a good idea. No, it's not a good idea. This shit leaks. It pokes holes. It leaks in there. Vapors come out. Your trunk's now a big freaking vapor. It's right next to your muffler, your spark arrestor, your freaking whatever. I mean, the odds of something going wrong is a lot higher when your trunk is filled with plastic bags and gas than if it's not. And we'll just leave it at that. Rick, you said don't give advice, and you just gave advice. Well, that's because that's kind of what I do here. That was just, I thought, a cute little, it looked like Mr. T and Buddy, but it's not, but they kind of did. So I like that little picture. I think I used it on a thumbnail. That was a video. I thought this was a great picture of the little doggy and the little baby coat. The baby, mom just had a little baby. And so mom's overlooking it and the dog's overlooking it. So obviously the dog and the mom have a good relationship. When you're working with horses, you know, when a mom bites a human, normally it's because a human goes in disrespectful with an attitude with, I can do what I want, I'm the high horse, and then the mom isn't ready, and then the mom kicks you. And then they end up beating the mom or telling the mom she's disrespectful or chasing it off the baby. And then they keep the mom off the baby to show them who's boss. And then when the mom rejects the baby, they post on the internet, oh, the mom rejected the baby and now I'm bottle feeding it and I'm saving it. So next time you see somebody bottle feeding and saving a baby, I guarantee you that's what freaking happened. Because if you're good with the mom, moms won't kick you and they'll let you in. They'll allow you in. But it has to be allowed in. It can't be forced in. And if you force your way in because you think you have to show them who's boss and you know everything about horses, that's when you get full rejections. And then you have to save the baby and bottle feed it. Welcome to the horse world. Cute little dog, cute little baby. I just thought that was a great picture. If you remember when I talked about leverage on the bits, I used this example. So this 5 kg, I'm just gonna go pound because I don't know this kilogram and kilometer and kilowatt and all this other shit. Okay, that's for the Europeans. All the people in Switzerland are like, I don't know the pounds and ounces. I know, but I do. Okay, so let's just imagine this is 5 pounds and this is 100 pounds. A 5 pound weight can support and lift 100 pounds if you get leverage. Leverage is distance. This is what you see when you see long shank bits. This is when I'm talking about long shank bits causing so much intense pain, even though it looks like the people pulling on the reins are soft and light. They're not soft and light. They're using leverage. So I just thought this was a great thing. I'm going to try to figure out a way to make this into a slide and put it on my website, connect it to a bit. But that's why that picture's here. Let's see here. That was good old Mr. T and Buddy in the snow. There's some birds eating some bird food. A little Texas snow dusting there. Actually, they both had, this must have been when it was freaking really, we were in the sub, because I don't put this on unless we get below zero. So it must have been in the negative. And so I threw their little blankets on and they got snow on it. So that either means they were rolling or it was snowing after I put it on. And that's when I got some new hay, and Moki wanted to do freaking, he's got to jump up and play King of the Hill when I get new hay in. He loves the new hay. My theory on this is all hay places have barn cats. And when you have new hay, where they belled it, because we don't grow the hay in Texas, alfalfa, we don't feed alfalfa grown in Texas because we have that beetle, that whatever that beetle is, that poisons horses. So we have to, Texas has to buy all alfalfa from other states that don't have that beetle. So all of our hay in Texas come from other states. So when you bell the hay, they put it in a barn, and they have barn cats. So there's cats, raccoons, possum, whatever. So there's all kind of animal smells on it. Then they load the hay in another state, and they bring it to the place that sells it here, either to another barn or to, you know, the place that sells it. And then that place has barn cats. Most places that have hay have barn cats because most places that have hay have mice, and people control the mice by having barn cats. So I think when I grab hay and I bring it home, Moki immediately runs around and sniffs it like there's another cat in the area. So I think he's smelling all those other cats from all the other barns that it came from. Moki just got his shots the other day, by the way. He hasn't had a shot since 2014. And the vet came out the other day and I told him to bring it for Moki and both horses. I got Ransom and Buddy vaccinated. Not with the COVID vaccine, just regular rabies and distemper and all that other shit. Moki cat, like, dude, why you pointing that camera at me? I ain't one of those horses. I ain't one of your damn trick ponies. I ain't doing shit. Get that camera out of my face. All right. That's another picture, I guess, of the boys in their little stall. Is that the same sunrise or a different one? That might be a different one. I think it is. I think it's more to the right. It might have been the same morning. And there's the snow with rabbits. I think that was before Stewie. So that's not Stewie rabbits. That's other critters coming around there. So So that's when my driveway was pretty much snowed in. There's a little rooster out there. See him? And there's Moki hiding from the freaking outdoor cold by the fireplace. There's Moki hanging out. I must have been doing a video on freaking Lester, because I've got, this is my video editing. So I must have been editing a video that I was doing on Lester's video, and Moki was up here getting in the way. Crazy cat. So this is a picture that I wanted to discuss, and this is as good as place any. Let me go to comments, see if I caught up on any comments. How did cats react to needles? Well, I do the same thing for cats and dogs and horses, and I call it the distraction method. So I distract them in some other area so they don't do it. So what the vet did, the doc goes, he goes, when I give cats, I usually do the neck grab, and I go, yeah, I'm fine with that, whatever. It's because usually when you grab a cat by the neck, they tend to remember when their mom grabbed them, and they tend to freeze up and don't move. You don't have to pick them up, but just grabbing by the neck and putting a little pressure puts them almost in a freeze response, or a, you know, don't move. When a mom's moving her babies, the babies go limp. They don't make noise. They don't cry. They don't do anything because they don't want to attract predators. So mom moves them with the mouth. So when you do that to a cat, they go into that instinctive kind of freeze mode. So when he grabs them by the neck and he lifts their skin so he can poke the needle in the skin in the back of the neck, I'm on their leg messing with their paw and their tail and their hip, and I'm rubbing them. So the cat is like, what's he doing to my leg? He's kind of in the freeze to the neck, and it's less likely that he's going to feel the needle prick. And Moki didn't move at all on both shots. He didn't even move because I was doing this on his leg, and the vet had him by the neck. So, you know, so when you ask how do cats react to needles, that's one of those questions that I always go crazy over, because it's like, it's not a question that you can answer. There's too many variables. Who's giving the shot? What size of the needle? Is it intermuscular, or is it under the skin, or is it in the vein? Does a person giving it know what they're doing? Are they distracting? Are they not distracting? Is the cat in a familiar place like Moki? We were in the middle of the garage. He wasn't worried about other things. It wasn't like I brought him to a vet with strange dogs barking and strange cats, and now they take him to back rooms, and there's dogs crying and barking and growling, and there's new vets coming in and handling them, and it's new smells, and they're unfamiliar. So, again, when you ask a question, there is so many variables in order to get a correct or logical or answer that really has meaning, you need to know more. So, you guys know how I am. The people that have been watching me know how I am on questions. Hi from Germany. North Carolina has no rain this summer. Huh. Yeah, King of the Hill. Remember that? Kids play that. You probably can't do that now. That's probably considered abusive and dominant behavior and bullying, and how dare somebody should be at the top of the hill. We have to let everybody at the top of the hill. And if anybody pushes them off, they're a bully now. So you can't play King on the Hill anymore. Can't do anything anymore without offending somebody. Why not COVID? You know what? And that's another great point. I hate going back to COVID, but when I say COVID is animal transferred. So if you have COVID, Lee, who has COVID in bed right now, if you're petting your dogs or your horse, not only can they catch COVID because it's transmittable, I think it's called zoonotic. Zoonotic is when a disease can go from animal to animal. I think that's, let me look up zoonotic real quick. Somebody be like, he don't even know what he's talking about. I'm pretty sure zoonotic means transferable between zoonotic disease. Let's see what it says here. Zoonotic, learn about zoonotic disease. I want the freaking definition. What are some zoonotic diseases? Influenza, West Nile, plague, rabies. These are all diseases, Lyme. These are all things that can be transferred. I thought the definition of it was freaking COVID-19. Is COVID-19 a zoonotic virus? The pandemic COVID-19 caused by SARS has been designated zoonotic, meaning it can be transferred from animal to animal, not in species. See, some things can only be transferred to like parvo and dogs. It can only go to dogs. It can't go to humans. Rabies can go to other animals, including humans. Rabies is zoonotic. Why the hell didn't I get let me try zoonotic definition. Let's see what it says there. Zoonotic diseases, also known as zoonosis, is caused by germs that spread between animals and people. Okay, so it spreads between animals and people. COVID is a zoonotic disease. Therefore, you can give it to your animals. Wait, your animals can give it to other people. So I don't even like petting other horses or dogs now, because I'm thinking humans, you get out there and you start petting dogs and pets and other horses, or you let your horses, you're at a stable and everyone pets your horse or feeds your horse, so they're all together. It's a COVID passing hot box. And guess what? All the handlers of all those animals that get COVID are wondering how they got it. It's probably from the animals that you're petting and handling. And Lee, I think, is working in a veterinarian clinic. So every animal that she comes in contact with is just like the human. If the human has kids, if the human has kids that got COVID and they're at home and they pet the animal and now they bring it to the vet clinic, and now Lee works on their dog. She could have caught COVID from one of these animals, and you wouldn't know it. So I hate going back to COVID, but it's related to animals, so I figured I would cover it. All right, let me get back to my pictures. Oh no, I was still on comments here. I wish I had a multitasking vet. That's not how it works where I live. Really? You know, my vet, his wife runs the small animal clinic and he runs the horse's large animal clinic. So because they're both vets and they both run the same building, if she needs a horse thing, she goes and gets it from him, horse meds. If he needs, you know, cat or dog meds, he goes and gets it. So when he comes out, I mean, I'm paying the $60 ranch call fee. When you have a vet come out, there's kind of like you got to pay, I call it a convenience fee. A lot of people call it the ranch call. If we come out, if you call them, they'll go, okay, we have a $60 ranch call fee. One freaking lady, man, she was an emergency vet. She goes, my fee's $200 to come out. Doesn't matter what I do or what I, if you just want me to come out and take the temperature, it's $200. Like, damn. And that's on top of it. She gives meds or has to do something. But anyway, needless to say, she didn't come out. Not that if I needed her. I end up bringing my horse to my vet. I couldn't get in touch with my vet. And I was calling in panic. She was the only one I got. And while I was talking to her, my vet called back and I was able to take my vet in. But if she would have been the only one, I'd have paid $200. I mean, I ain't got no freaking choice. I wanted my horse to get checked, or I forgot what it was for. But anyway, if you asked your vet, Gwen, about, hey, I've got a cat, and you know, a lot of them, if they're large animal, they don't want to do this. I know I'm going to piss off some women here. I'm going to be in a bad mood. Here we go. A lot of women tend to be crazy animal hoarders. So vets, when they deal with people a lot, they don't. My vet doesn't go out to a lot of places for that. I know all my other past vets will not take certain clients. They just stay away from them. They go, no, I don't want them. I don't want their business. It's too much problems. My phone rings 24/7 every time the dog, cat, horse sneezes, the goat does this, whatever. They just don't want to deal with it. So if your vet knows you and you pay a ranch fee and have them come out with your horses, if you say, hey, so I just don't have to take my cat. Now, if you go, hey, can you bring out for my cat and my three goats and my two sheep and my cow? He's probably going to be like, you know what? Maybe that won't be an issue. But I've got a cat and I'm like, can you bring out for my cat? And he's like, sure, no problem. So it's not a big deal for me. If you talk to him, they'll do it. He just bills me for the cat vaccine. He actually gave me a tag this time. I never got a little tag. He goes, here's your tag. And I go, what the hell am I going to do with this? He don't have a collar. Well, if he bites somebody, you can show it to him. I hung it somewhere. I'm like, shit, if he bites somebody, I'm going to be calling you and saying, hey, when'd you vaccinate him? Because the last time you vaccinated Moki was in 2014. So anyway, but Moki's, he kills so many rabbits, he eats so many birds. I was like, you know what? Let me just give him, you know, I hate sticking chemicals in him because, you know, we don't know what it does the animal. We don't know if it makes them feel bad. We don't know if they're having reactions they can't tell us. You know, we can only go on visual reactions. Are they sick? Are they throwing up? Are they lethargic? Are they breaking out in a rash? We can see those, but we can't see that it feels bad or he, you know, we can't see any of that. So anyway, my vet brought it out. I wonder how long cat pheromones stick around. Yeah, who knows? I mean, you know, animals have such an acute smell. you know, it's like crazy. You know, that's why when a horse wants to smell something or react to something, or my dog, I hated people that didn't like their dog doing anything. You know, I don't like robot horses, the control people that just freaking have to control their horse and they want their horse to stand there not doing anything unless they tell them. And I don't like dogs that way either. I mean, it just drove me nuts. I remember one time I really got in this one handler's ass. I didn't get in a lot of guys' ass, but if I got in your ass, you knew I was in your ass. And this guy kept making his dog sit in the concrete. It was 100 freaking degrees, and the dog kept standing up, and he would correct the dog. No, sit. And the dog would sit down. I'd see his back leg shaking and his nuts were hitting the ground, and the dog would stand up, be dancing around. The handler was so focused on making his freaking dog listen that he didn't know the dog was freaking reacting because his ass was burning. Quit making your dog. So he did it like 3 times and I went off on his ass. And I mean, when I go off on your ass, you know it. And I was in his ass. You take your motherfucking pants off and sit your ass on the motherfucking ground. Don't make your dog sit on freaking hot concrete and be a dumbass and correct. I mean, I was in his ass. And he was like, okay, Sergeant Gore, sorry. And that was the end of it. And you know, I mean, we were buddies and we went out later drinking, you know, weeks later or whatever, after he got off there, his butt hurt and whatever. But, you know, and I could have wrote him up for it and documented it if I want to be a real dick. I could have gave him a letter of reprimand for animal abuse or whatever and really screwed him. But I figure if I can just chew your ass and make the point, then we'll move on. So anyway, that was one of the days I was in a bad mood. Let's see if anybody's telling me I'm in a bad mood today. Let's see here. Let's go down to comments, see who the hell I can kick out of here. Gabby's, I hadn't had a chance to watch. Man, that Gabby case is really kind of interesting now because I didn't know about this hour video. They had contact with him before she disappeared. I mean, everybody kept telling me on my gun channel, the Gab. So if you don't know about the Gabby case, that's the little 22-year-old girl that disappeared with her fiance. They went on a trip. She's texting her mom every day. She's videotaping her mom every day. Suddenly, no message. Suddenly, fiance shows up. And girlfriend's nowhere to be found. And when they ask him what happened, he won't talk to him. So they file a missing persons, cops go over, talk to him, and boyfriend has a lawyer. Okay, so we call that a clue. He killed her. People don't want to say she's dead. They're looking for her and all this shit. So I'm getting heat from that because I'm saying this is the Gabby murder, and everybody's pissed off at me. She's not dead. And if the family sees this, you're being mean, and you're trying to make the family distress, and you're an asshole, and you should never say she's dead. We don't know. We could find... She's dead, people. Look, a girl... She was very emotional. This is before I seen the hour video. So anyway, she's missing. Everybody kept telling me to do the video. So I open up on my live and I look at CNN was the first thing that came up and I read the article. So I go through in my mind, if I was the investigator, by what they're saying in this article, what my steps would be and how I would investigate it. Well, of course, I pissed people off because they're like, you didn't even see the video. You don't know what you're talking about. Blah. So then I went and watched this hour long video, or I watched like 15 minutes of it. And then I did a 6-part or 5-part series on evaluating what the cops did on this video and why I still think she's dead and why I'm sure that this guy killed her. Now, he's not going to admit it. Look, people, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. Boyfriend and girlfriend, fiance, go on a trip. They have an argument. She's contacting mom every day. Before on this trip, cops get involved because they have a domestic violence and she scratched and hit him. That's why everybody's pissed off. Saying it wasn't his fault. They're defending him. And, you know, now I'm a man hater because I'm saying he's guilty and he did it. And everybody's saying it's the woman and she was the problem and she hit him and all this. So it's a very convoluted case, but it's getting good because the attorney is kind of diming the family out and we have attorneys involved. Now the FBI is involved. And now the big twist of the case, the boyfriend that came back without the girlfriend and will not talk to cops and has a lawyer, now he's disappeared. And now I think I just heard that there's 2 other women that were a witness to the fight and they were found dead. And I'm like, dude, if that's true, I got to do a couple videos on that. So that's kind of what I'm working on that one. Recommendation, I Survived. That's a great show. It's a really great learning. It shows the human psyche. I talked about it on my gun channel. If you watch that show, it really shows about fight and fear and how the mind doesn't work like you expect it to work. And when it goes down the lizard brain and you're totally working on survival, things happen, slow motion speeds up, time distortion. I mean, that show just really, when you listen to these people tell their stories, they actually relive it. And you can, they get emotional, they cry, they shake. You can tell by their blinking of their eyes go up because they're talking about something so emotional and close because most all of the I Survived is a near-death experience. So I'm surprised they haven't got Lester on I Survive from his donkey and ostrich experience. I can see Lester on I Survive. And I was feeding animal crackers to the ostrich, and suddenly his feet were kicking, and I was that would be a great show. I Survive, Lester. Rick, why are you picking on Lester? Whatever. Freaking crybabies coming here wanting to stir up trouble. I got some woman that just freaking hates me every time I critique one of Lester's videos. And I mean, she's just relentless. She's got to come here, tell me how I'm wrong, and he loves his animals, and I'm just picking on him, and he's learning, and he's dangerous, and I should be trying to help him instead of critiquing him. And I mean, I just get this big dissertation from her every time I do a video. Oh, that's right. Leica going, I Survived for the rabbit bite. They can have a big rabbit there. Here's Leon, I Survived. Because they usually get really, really close up on the people. So here's Leon, I Survived. And I was working on this rabbit. And then all of a sudden, the rabbit. And then they always put dramatic music in the background, and they zoom in on the person. I love that show. I'm sorry, man. That's a great freaking show. Oh, shit. Rick, you're in a bad mood. Why are you laughing? Shut up with the bad mood. You're going to get your ass blocked. Oh, isn't that a shame? I've got to literally threaten to block people in order to get them to quit posting and crying and shit. Love, I Survived. I like it too. Hi from Michigan. Michigan with the big M. I got a hat with a big M. I thought it was for Mickey Mouse, but people told me it was for Michigan. Rick needs an ostrich. Dude, I would love to get an ostrich. I swear that I think it would be a cool animal. I mean, I think that ostrich is like taking over the herd. And he's kind of gotten this this leadership role, and he walks around like he actually has a job. And again, I'm only seeing videos. I don't know what's happening. That's not videotaped. And that's the problem with doing reaction videos on things, because you have all these people that come here. You know what you're talking about? Because I read this and I saw this, and there's another video that you didn't want. And then everybody wants to tell you how you got it wrong. So I don't know what I don't know on Lester's ostrich. But from what I see, he seems like he's pretty happy, well-adjusted. I've got a job. I'm eating. I'm comfortable with you guys. He's not attacking. He's not showing this negative behavior to where he's aggressive to everybody except Lester. And then, but I think Lester's the only one that kind of interacts and feeds and does shit with him. So obviously, the odds of Lester having a negative interaction is high because he has a lot of interaction. It's kind of like if you drive for a living, the odds of you having a car accident is much greater than if you never drive. You know, it's like me bragging. I've never driven. I don't own a car, and I've never had a car accident. Well, no shit. You've never driven. I mean, Rick, why are you in a bad... Shut up. The bad mood shit. You can only react to him. Yeah. Imaginary shit. What the government keeps telling us we should be reacting to. I got to turn the fan on. Is that fan? Can y'all hear that fan? Man, that thing's on low on like speed one. I got it way in a corner. But it freaking, it moves some air. I don't know what kind of fan it is, but what does it say? Maybe the little remote says what kind of fan. Oh, it's one of those. That's what the little remote says. It was like $23 at Sam's or something. I said, damn, $23 for a fan and a remote? I was like, shit, I was all over that. No fan noise. Thank you. Look at the little rabbit. Oh, shit. Lay, don't watch this comment. Look at the cute little rabbit. Man, look at those teeth. Good. I'm glad you can't hear it. Hang on. Let's do this test. Let me turn it up to volume 3 and see if you can hear it. So you can't hear it now. That's volume 3. Can you hear it now? That's 2. And that's 1. All right. No fan sound. All right. Cool. Shocker. Carl's taking over the babies. That's a good thing. I think it gives them a job. I don't necessarily think that's bad. The problem with him taking over the babies, I think, is going to come when he gets protective or he owns them and it's his herd. And now you need to either pay respect or show homage to him in order to have access to the babies, because he's going to want to protect them. It's just like a mom protecting her baby. If you don't do it the right way, she's going to react to you. And then if you react to her in an aggressive manner, then she's going to disengage with you and the baby and think it's inappropriate. Because remember, when you correct a horse that does something to you because you have a, because she's protecting her baby and you're too stupid to know it, and you did something stupid and you put yourself in there and it's your freaking fault, and then you correct that horse, and the horse, you think you're correcting the horse for kicking you. The horse thinks he protect or she protected her baby and she got corrected, so she shouldn't correct her baby. Maybe that's not her baby. Maybe she should stay away from her baby. And that's how you get full rejection. No, Rick, I had a baby, and if I had to save the baby, I get so tired of the baby breath. Holy shit. Dude, I don't know if you guys can see those freaking vultures out there. Are the vultures coming up in my driveway? There's like five of them. Hang on, let me try to spin my little focuser. Man, I don't know if y'all can see that. There's one, two, three, four, five freaking vultures out there on my driveway, and I know exactly what they're looking at. I changed my focus. Hang on, let me see if I can focus in on the Buddy and Mr. T sign in the back. Oh, shit. Now I'm going to get all the, Rick, your camera's out of focus. I'm sorry. Well, shit, whatever. If it's out of focus, it's out of focus. All right. So anyway, I know what those vultures are at. As a matter of fact, I took a damn picture because I saw these and I was like, what the hell is this? Maybe my viewers will know what the hell this is. So there was two dead things on the ground out there when I was walking the other day, and they look like mice that have been partly dissolved. And I'm like, hang on, let me make this bigger. Maybe you can see it. Is that coming out? So anyway, I'm taking a walk. Here, I'll forward this to my email and then I'll open it. Rick, you shouldn't be doing that. You should have planned better. And now I'm in a bad mood because I got to watch you. Shut up. Freaking. All right. So it'll take a minute to come here and I'll show you what's happening. Sometimes it comes fast, sometimes it doesn't. Yeah, see, it's not here. Imagine that. So now I gotta wait until it shows up. So hopefully it remind me to go back to that. All right, let me go to new comments, see what the hell we're talking about. How do you sleep, Rick? Why do people feel the need to grab and pull babies away? I know, I don't get it. And it's mostly women, and I would think out of every, you know what? Let me try to focus this with, now that it's bigger. Is that better? You would think women, because they're maternal, would be like, don't mess with a mom and a baby. But it's, I mean, I've seen guys do it. I get it. It's not all women, but most women are in the horse world. And every time you hear about a foal rejection, you have some woman there. I had to save the baby. And I had to bottle feed it, and now it sleeps with me in my bed, and it needs me. Jesus Christ. Really, people? Pythons throw their food up? Really? Dude, that was a freaking... I mean, those mice look literal. Oh, I think it came in. It did. All right. So now I have to save these two photos. Save picture. We'll go 111. Okay. And I'm going to save this picture as 2222. And now I'm going to find 1111. Oh, shit. I didn't look at where it saved it. Normally, it saves it on here. Crap. Really? If it's on my desktop, it should come up. I didn't even get to the rest of my pictures. I don't even know where I was at. You would, oh, there they are. Okay. So it literally looks like these two mice have been partially digested. And I was kind of like, what the hell is that? And they're both just laying there on the roadway. And I'm like, right next to the driveway. And I'm like, what the hell? And there was another one right over here. I think the other picture is. Yeah. So there's another part of some sort of decayed animal here. And to me, I thought it was first an owl. Because I think owls kind of shit their food out. Oh, I can't say shit because somebody's kids might be listening. And then I'm going to have to get a complaint that I'm leaving because you said shit and I don't want my kids to hear. Whatever. So I don't know what the hell that looks like a bird or maybe a baby owl. I don't know what the hell that is. But it's not too far away from the two freaking partially digested thingies. Let me go comment, see if anybody's got an idea on what the hell's going on here. See, I was thinking owls too. That was my first thought. And usually I have a big ass white owl around here and he's big. He's big enough to carry Stewie away. So if he's around, Stewie's days may be numbered because I've seen him come down and swoop by and I literally thought it was a freaking alien spaceship. I was like, what the hell just flew by Miami? It was huge at night. He sits in that tree out there and I'll hear him. Ooh, ooh. And then all of a sudden, and I'll see these freaking like a helicopter taking off and he's flying by. Okay. Snowy owl. Most people are going, I don't have poison out here. So I doubt they would have made it all the way here eating poison. I don't have any rat poison out here. So it's not rat poison. Owls puke up the bones and crap. Maybe they puked them up because they weren't good. Looks like a little bird to me. They're not birds. Those are mice. Well, you know what? I thought they were mice. Look at the fly. That's pretty good camera, man. That camera picked up that freaking fly. I'm getting a better camera too. I'm all excited. I'm going to order me the iPhone 13 because I have the iPhone 11 and I've had it, I don't know, 2 or 3 years. And the iPhone 13 is supposed to have a badass camera. See, that doesn't look like a bird to me. That looks like an eye with a little mouse face. And I don't know what the hell this one. Oh, this is the wrong picture. I don't know what this guy is. I couldn't even make it out. Maybe somebody can make it out. Definitely would love owl footage. Yeah, I can't videotape at night. Maybe if I get the 13, it might have some night vision. I know the camera's supposed to be a big old vulture sitting on that gate. I thought it was one of the horses standing there. I go, damn, what's that big thing about the gate? It's a freaking big old vulture. That sucker's huge. Anyway, get a stick and dissect them. No, I'll pass. I'm not that curious. As a matter of fact, all those vultures are out there. There won't be nothing to dissect. They're gone. That's the good thing about vultures is they're great for cleanup. Look like rats, mice, whatever. I can't keep up with all those damn things. Those vultures keep coming by. They're like freaking airplanes. I wish you guys, were y'all able to see them when they were flying around and moving? Can y'all make that out at all? Are they coming in? There's only two there now. Huh. Oh, well. It's nice to have live, but that solar screen really messes up Am I kind of in a center? Yeah, I'm kind of innocent. We have solar screens in Texas, so they're like a thicker, blacker screen on top of your bug screen to stop the sun. So when you have two screens and a window, a double pane window, trying to videotape through it, doesn't work too well. I mean, I've got my binoculars up here. It's even hard for me to see, make out things at my gate sometimes when I'm sitting up here and somebody pulls up to my gate. Can't see the vultures. Thank you, Lacey. Yeah, sorry. They're clear as day to me, but that little camera probably ain't picking it up. Fox or coyote, they wouldn't have left them. Those two have definitely been some sort of digested. They've either gone through a snake or an owl. They are not, no sea vultures. Yeah, I know. Sorry. All right. So anyway, those are the pictures. Anyway, I got to get back to my picture thing here. Where were we? Oh, there we were. So this thing only explained as aliens. Yeah, it could be aliens. That's what some idiot said that happened to that girl. Why are you blaming the guy, Rick? It was probably aliens took her, and you're already concluding that the guy killed her. I said, look, no fiance goes on a trip, has a domestic violent incident, takes the keys, holds her out of the car, locks the car, and doesn't let her in because she's having emotion. Now, look, this girl is emotional wreck. She's on meds. She's got OCD, and he's got issues because he wouldn't drink water. Although he's hot and complaining of water, they offer him water, and he doesn't like plastic. So he wouldn't drink the water. So they both have their little, hey, we're, you know, people say I'm OCD because I don't want to shake hands. Whatever. You can call it what you want. Both these people are not the greatest couple. So, but I was getting shit because I'm picking on a guy and saying it's unfair that I'm taking a girl's side. I'm like, all right, whatever. All right. So I looked up owl pellets regurgitated the undigested bone and hair. The pics look just like, oh, no shit. So it must be an owl. That was my first thought when I saw it. I go, damn, I must have an owl. And he ate two. Because if he spit them out, it wasn't like I ate one, spit it out, and I just happened to fly by the exact same spot and spit the other one out. He had two of those big boys in him that he spit out. So he's got to be a pretty good size freaking owl. Would have been easier to identify before they ran into what, whatever it was. What? I don't think they ran into anything. Statistically, it's most likely to be the boyfriend or husband. Well, not necessarily just boyfriend or husband. It's most likely to be the wife or girlfriend, too. Almost all murders are committed by somebody you know. One. Two is usually somebody that you have said, I love you. That's my theory. I don't have anything to back that up. I'm just telling you. In all my cases, all my studies, all my career, that's it. And that's why people usually focus on the closest people. Very, very rarely are there stranger abductions and stranger murders. Now, if it's in the commission of a felony, a guy who robs a bank and he shoots somebody, yeah, that's one thing. But when you find mysterious dead bodies, when it's not obvious there's a crime, that's why a lot of guys who kill them want to set up a crime because they think it throws us off that, oh, we'll take a couple things and they'll think it's a burglary. Well, we ain't found a body yet. So everybody's like, well, she's not dead, Rick. Okay, whatever. Owls will often regurgitate at the same spot. So you think it landed there and just, you think it came back a second time? Let me get this straight. You say single because if you meet somebody, you think they're going to kill you? Oh, shit. That's funny. That made me almost put coffee in my nose. All right. I know. Sometimes it catches you by surprise. All right. So let's get to this video here or this picture. So somebody sent me this picture. I don't know how or why I got this. And again, I have things. So sometimes I'll just download them on my computer so I can look at it. And then I'll figure out where I'm going to stick it in a video or whatever. But since I'm doing a live, I'll just stick it in here. So we have a horse that's laying here. When I first saw it, I was like, damn, is that thing dead? Usually a horse doesn't just drop dead like that next to a fence. But then let's read how a person describes it. First of all, she's fine, just dumb. Wow. Anybody make any conclusions? I know I'm always getting shit. Rick, you're too judgmental. Anybody make any conclusions at all on this woman? I don't even know if it's a woman. I'm just guessing it's a woman. I could be wrong. This might be a man. I'm saying it's a woman. First of all, she's fine, just dumb. I'm like, perfect. And somebody else blocked out this name. I don't know where this came from or who it belongs to. Okay, so now we know, at least we know we're dealing with a dumb horse, right? I mean, the owner says it's dumb. Must be dumb, right? Because horses are dumb and they do stupid shit and, you know, must be dumb. And there's a lot of people that believe what I'm saying. I'm being sarcastic for those that don't believe it. I was standing in the barn on Friday afternoon. Cricket was making laps running around the pasture with her sliding stop didn't go as planned. So here's what she described as happened. I don't believe that. I'm standing in the barn Friday. No, you weren't. You probably just let the horse out. You put food out. You just gave it grain. You had the horse locked up and you released it. And it was so excited to be free, it ran around. That sounds more logical and reasonable to me. Was making laps. I've never seen my horses, when I'm not involved, making laps by themselves. Never. Never happened. Never. Matter of fact, I can't think of ever seeing a horse just running around laps when nobody's around, not doing anything. Now, when you get humans involved, like this Miss Innocent who thinks she has a dumb horse, just minding her own business, standing in the barn. Okay, perfect. And these videos, I mean, these comments and things like that just drive me nuts. I watched it happen, y'all. She busted her butt, slid under the fence with one foot resting on the wire. Literally, all of that was off kilter. But when she pulled her foot, her shoe came caught. Oh, so now we have shoes and a pasture and maybe a halter. I don't know if she put the halter on afterwards, whether that halter was already on it or she put it on it. But so now her hoof, her shoe is caught to the fence. Another reason I don't like horseshoes in pastures. I know all the horseshoe lovers will be here. Rick, my horse needs shoes because it's got bad feet. And my vet said it has to have shoes. And my farrier said it had to have shoes. And my horse didn't do it. And when I took the shoes off, it started limping. So I had to put shoes on and it had to have shoes. Your horse don't need freaking shoes, people. I mean, I would literally say less than 1%, maybe 5% of horses may need shoes. But when I say that, every freaking person out there that has a horse that has shoes thinks they're in that 5%. And they will justify it till the heels come home that my horse needs shoes. I'm in the 5%. And they're not. 99% of horses do not need shoes, people. That would leave 1% that does. So, look, they just don't need them. They've had them for so long. When they're trimmed and take them off, they get tenderfooted. People think they need them. They put them back on. If you like your shoes off your horse for a year, 9 times out of 10, you're not going to need it. Now, if you're being a dumbass and you're overweight and you're riding your horse on hard ground and you're making your horse jump and you're doing barrels and then your horse starts limping when he doesn't have shoes, well, you may think he needs shoes because he needs them when in fact he needs them because he's carrying your ass around over jumps and around barrels. And that's why he needs them. So get it straight and say what it is. Okay. Her foot got caught on the wire and she thought she was trapped, but she's stupid. I'm glad she thought she was trapped. I want a horse to think they're trapped. I don't want them fighting, kicking wildly because one, they may trap themselves. Two, they'll do more damage. And it's just better if they do go submissive when they get caught. That's why I hobble train my horses. I want them to learn when their feet are tied. If I don't fight it, I can just stand there and I can still move. It's not the end of the world. So this woman thinks her horse is stupid because she didn't fight with the barbed wire. Me, I think it's a good horse and a smart horse. I'm pretty sure I ain't met the horse or the woman. I think the horse is smarter than the woman. Rick, you just don't like women because you're in a bad mood. Shut up, you freaking crazy people. So she died right then and there. Just gave up on life completely and said, might as well go get the backhoe. Is this heifer? Refused to stand up. Eyes closed. No, mom is dead. What? Dead? Like D-E-A-D or dead like Ned dead, dead? Dead Zed said Led was dead. What? Probably from embarrassment. Oh, yeah. Because horses always just die from embarrassment. Yeah, because horses feel embarrassment like their owners. Remember, when owners call horses names, they are reflecting on themselves, on what they are. When somebody calls their horse dumb or stupid, they literally are admitting that they're dumb and stupid. When somebody says their horse is embarrassed, they're embarrassed. When they call their horses names, they're too stupid to learn, they're ignorant, whatever, they're describing themselves, okay? Probably from embarrassment, when I finally convinced her to roll over, oh, look, the woman came and saved the day. The woman convinced the horse because the horse was stupid and dumb and gave up and was embarrassed. The woman saved the day and convinced the horse to roll her big ass over. I mean, just look at, listen to this comment. This woman has contempt, total contempt, no respect for the horse. Thinks she's brilliant and she has a dumbass horse that she has to save. I haven't even met this woman and I don't freaking like her. Rick, you just hate all women. Shut up, you freaking idiots. Okay. When I finally convinced her to roll over because I'm the savior, I came in with my big Wonder Woman cape and get up. She got up holding her leg off the ground like it was broke. Stupid horse. Maybe it had lost blood flow. Maybe it was tingling. Maybe she didn't know if it was hurt and didn't want to put weight on it. Again, once again, I'm siding with the horse is smarter than the freaking woman that's coming in to save the day. Holding her leg off the ground like that, you know, the trap leg. I made her walk because I'm smart. I'm powerful. I'm strong. I'm empowered. I control my horse. I show her who's boss. I made her walk because I saved the day. And she hobbled four strides. So this woman's convinced that this horse is hobbling or not putting weight on it because she's faking it, because she's embarrassed. See how she's reflecting all of her own feelings and emotions on this poor horse? I mean, I see this 99 times out of 100 every time somebody wants to tell me about a horse problem. I made her walk. She hobbled four strides before she set it on the ground like, oh, I still have a leg. And then trotted around in circles, blowing and snorting from her near-death experience. And the award for best drama goes to Cricket. You know what? With your post, I'm pretty sure you got the most drama award, lady. But we don't even know if this is a woman, right? This is probably a man. I should have been saying, oh, no, wait a minute. There's a woman in the photo. Here she is. I think that's a woman. I don't know if I can call her a woman. Will I get in trouble? Does anybody know the proper pronoun for her? All right. So this is why I stay off social media a lot, like Facebook and Instagram and all of this shit, because I see posts like this and they just irritate me. They get me in a bad mood. Then I want to yell and block somebody. The horse is always smarter. Yeah, no shit. What did Dave say that everybody's laughing about? She's trying to be humorous. Okay, I get it. She is trying to be humorous. However, she's being humorous by calling her horse stupid and dumb. And I think it is an actual reflection of who she is and what she sees and how she lives life. You may think she's just being humorous. This is funny. I don't find this funny. I don't think she's being humorous. I might be the one with no sense of humor. Maybe it's just me. I just don't, you know what? My horse got hurt and stuck in a fence. I mean, I call Buddy dumb sometime and he's being silly. And when he slipped, I laughed at him. I mean, I get it. But to start off, the horse is just dumb. That's a negative attitude. The horse is embarrassed, thinks his leg is broke. I mean, her whole tone in this is her superior over the horse and how stupid and inept and how the horse needs saving by her brilliant, maybe sarcastic, smart. Okay. How did I know a woman would be defending this? And you don't know any more than I know. So I could be wrong. I could be right. You could be wrong or you could be right. All right. We'll agree to disagree. I don't think it's humorous. But whatever. We can have our own opinion. Uh, Yeah, locus, locat, sense of humor. Locat. That LOL cat? Locat? Sense of humor. I can't read comments either. Horse is definitely smarter than human. Yeah, no shit. Miss Tree. All right, I don't know. Let me go down to new comments here. Get down to the bottom. I think that's an electric fence, not barbed wire. Really? How do you know that? Oh, because of the little thingies. Yeah, you're probably right. I didn't see the, what do they call those? Isolators or insulators or... So the thing won't ground out. So I think that is an electric fence. But I mean, would this woman have preferred the horse with her shoe caught on the fence to kick and tear down her whole fence and run away with wire dragging and kicking and tear? Is that what she wanted? Because she said the horse was dumb for laying there and thinking she was broken. So I'm not sure what the right answer is. My guess is this horse doesn't know what the right answer is most of the time either. Just a guess. Could be wrong. Good catch on the electric fence. Isolators. That's what I was listening for. Thank you. Grounders. Okay. Insulators. Okay. Whatever they are, we've got the same terminology somewhere around here. Horse shocked and can't move. I don't know if it's shocked. I mean, look, horses, when an animal grabs them by the neck, they stop fighting. They accept death. Horses accept their fate all the time. It's what they do. When you get a horse to give up and stop fighting, they kind of accept it. That's why you get these Amish people that will tie a horse down, throw a tarp over him, beat him with a broom, and do cruel shit to him. They accept their fate once they realize they have no other choice. So you can either get them to accept their fate because they accept something willingly and they learn what the right answer is and they work with you, or you can get them to accept their fate through brutal, torturous tactics. That horse looks pretty thin. I don't know if the horse looks thin to me. Let me see if the horse looks thin. Nah, I don't think it looks thin to me. It doesn't look fat like Buddy. Not that Buddy's fat, even though Jenny Craig calls him twice a day. I'm not sure he's too skinny. I mean, I've seen him standing up. I don't know if that's a rib bone there. But if he's laying down, he's really thin. I think I would be seeing ribs, and I don't really see. Oh, here's a skid mark, I guess. We get it. The horse fell. Poor little horse. I'd be feeling sorry for it. It's okay, buddy. Let me help you out. I'd unhook him, let him stand up. If he wanted to limp, I'd be like, it's okay. You're okay. Maybe I'd go back there and massage his leg, get the blood flowing, make sure there isn't an injury, let him know he can put it down, maybe pick it up, put it down, help him figure out that he's okay, and we'd move on. I'd want to help the horse instead of call it names. Rick, she was being funny. Okay, I got it. I got it. I think she has been zapped. And a mental shot made it worse. Could have been a little stun. I mean, I don't know if this woman unhooked the fence, if it was still going. I mean, most electric fences are pulsating. There are some that are constant. The electrical charge is always going through. And then they have some that send a charge every 2 or 3 seconds, 5 seconds. I don't know if you can adjust it. I've never had an electric fence, but I've been around them. And if you really want to know if it's working, the best way is just to pee on it. And then you can tell, it'll give you a little tingle that it's working. But, you know, electric fences, if it shocked it, maybe it hurt it. Maybe when the horseshoe hit it and he's on the ground, it grounded out. Maybe he's getting a light charge and he doesn't want to move. I mean, all those things could be true, but why would you blame a horse for not moving when he's trapped? I mean, to me, that's a good thing. Why would you do that? I hate sliding down all the time. I get moving and my ass slides forward. I'm sliding down the chair. Anyway, good one, Art. I saw good Art come by. What was Art's comment? Pleasantly plump. I would say that horse played. Maybe Buddy's pleasantly plump. A little tingle. Well, I mean, you know, when your arm falls asleep, I mean, I don't know the time frame. Again, there's a lot I don't know. I don't know how far it slid. Did it hit his head when it slid? Did he get shocked when it went down? Did it try to get up and then didn't get up? Or did it just completely go into freeze mode? You know, there's so much I don't know. But if he was there for a while and she had time to get her camera, go over and take multiple pictures, I'm thinking a horse laying there for a while. So when my arm goes asleep, I like to move it and kind of get the blood flowing. If my foot's asleep, I got to wiggle it around sometimes, or I walk like I'm a crazy person or I'm on one leg. So, I mean, if a horse is laying there for a while and it got a little tingly or the blood flow went away, by massaging it and getting the blood flow like I would do to myself, if my hand went to sleep, I would massage it to get that tingling feeling out. So maybe, I mean, that's what I was talking about. I don't know if I wasn't clear. But he's perfect. Ain't no damn perfect horse. That may be Mr. T. He was pretty perfect. Good old Mr. T. Speaking of Buddy, there's the boy. He's out there. The birds are gone. Now he's out there. He's eating in the same spot. Let me see if you guys can see the horse because he's bigger. We'll spin us around. Rick, quit moving the camera. Oh, be quiet. Can y'all see Buddy over there? He's like right there. Let me move it closer. Move it away. I don't know if you guys can see that. How was that? I keep moving this damn camera. I've got this camera sitting on a freaking, it looks like this. The old tennis thing. Remember, I don't know if you need to play tennis. You can't see? Damn. Well, Buddy's sitting out there eating exactly where him and Ransom ate. And evidently, Ransom must have left a little kernel of alfalfa. And he's out there cleaning up. I got to start giving him a little bit more because I've been giving him one flake between the two of them for a while. And I mean, but he doesn't look like he's losing weight. But I can tell when they're a lot more motivated when I bring it out there and they eat it and they like stay and eat everything and they don't leave anything. When I'm feeding them a lot, there's a lot of green grass. They'll nibble. They'll leave the long hay and they'll come back later and snack on it. But now, as the grass is kind of losing its nutrition, starting to move into fall, that, you know, where we pass the spring grass where it's full of nutrition, now they seem very interested in the little kernels. And because of that, I'm thinking I might need to up it a little bit. But, I mean, I don't want to put weight. Ransom's looking pretty round, and Buddy's looking pretty round. So I may just have to just eat my feel sorry for them because they look hungry and say, you know what, I'm just going to only give them one flake a day. And I mean, they're still getting their little snack of grain and they're not, I'm not in danger of starving them. I would just like them to lose. I'd like to lose weight. I think they're healthier. I'm healthier when I lose weight. They're healthier when they lose weight. It's just better. So, and you know, there's really no reason that I need to feed them and add extra weight if they're already at a good weight. I feed them more as a routine. They come to me, they expect it. I can do my daily inspection of them. Make sure there's no cuts, injuries, no limps, bruises, etc. I can rub them. I can pull on their tail. I can do a little sacking out, check their belly, let them know that I can still touch them everywhere. Make sure we're not losing this hierarchy or this herd thing. They still know that I'm the boss. They still know that, you know, how to react around me, etc. If I didn't feed them or do anything, like a lot of people do, they have pasture horses and then they don't do anything with the horse. Then all of a sudden there's, my horse won't let me catch him. My horse won't listen to me. My horse tried to kick me. My heart. The people would get it. All right. Oh, did you ever get unblocked, Lacey? Blue liquor? What? All fine. All right. I got to go back to my other pictures. Well, now that I've covered this, I can get rid of this. Unless I want to put on my, I don't need to put that on my website. All right, I'll just get rid of that one. What's the next picture? That was some stupid Google survey. There's the old picture of old Mr. T. Before he passed, protecting his little girl, telling Buddy, yeah, youngster, pay attention. What a great freaking horse. Buddy's like, oh shit, the old man's got his mouth open. Poor old Mr. T. All right, so that's an old Ford picture. That's some Buddy ran into trees, MP4. I don't know if I posted that video or not. It's obviously an old video because it's got the railroad ties before the concrete. So I don't know if I posted that or not. I'll have to go and. So these are the things that I've got like for my page I'm going to make on the Warhorse Paint. I'm collecting images and I'm putting them to know so I can do a good in-depth detail. So if somebody wants to know about what war paint is, because I got shit when Lester put, a handprint on his horse, and I didn't know what it meant. Everybody gave me shit. You're supposed to know horses. I'm like, oh, whatever. I said, I don't do Indian horse a lot. But I said, you know what? There's probably other people that don't know, so I'll use this as a learning opportunity. I'll get up to speed on it. I'll research it, and I'm going to make a nice web page or a PDF file that you can click on, and it will open up with all this information. So that's why I have these pictures of all this war paint stuff. That's a great little picture. What the feather means, hands, the bars on the nose, the circle around the eye. They all have specific meanings. And I'm going to try and document all that in one place. This was, I talked about being on the government tit earlier. This is a cop in, where was it? Argentina. She found a kid that was malnourished or whatever. And she decided, since she was breastfeeding, to feed the kid. And I talked about on my gun channel what would happen if a male cop or a female cop did that here in the U.S. Well, now I guess a male cop could do it because, you know, if somebody said that a male cop did this and he was wrong, he would get charged with PC or using the wrong pronoun. This is a movie of, oh yeah, I already covered that one, I thought. So this is a picture before old Mr. T. No, this is another movie of Mr. T where he was trying to get the donkey away from her, I think. I haven't posted that yet. This is another movie. I don't know what it is. Black stuff on the horses. Oh, I got to do that video on that tar stuff. This is a movie about Buddy nibbling on the little grass. He found a little bit of green grass and he was really nibbling and I tried to get a close up. So I don't think I've posted that one yet either. Another page I got to add to my website is about horsepower and where it came from and exactly what it is and how it's determined what exactly is. And there's a lot of confusion on it. As I started doing research on it, it's like everything else. It turns into this big bucket of like, holy shit, I didn't think about that. And the first guy that did it on a horse of a wheel going this way, and it was raising a water bucket this way. And then the other guy transformed it to pulling, and then it was lifting. And so there's a lot of different things. So I'm trying to get a good page or thing on what horsepower is and how we designate horsepower, et cetera. But I haven't finished that yet, as you can tell. And that's just a picture of the boys eating. That's when I had him locked out. Remember? I didn't want Buddy in there, and I locked his ass out. And then I got all this heat because I was being mean, and I should let him grieve the way he wants to. And I'm interfering with the grieving process, and I shouldn't be interfering. And I tell other people not to interfere, but now that I'm interfering, it's okay. And I'm a hypocrite. And, you know, so again, every video I got, there's always the thousands of people that's got to tell me how I got it freaking wrong. That's me when I was working as a cop. That's the pond when it was full. I figured I'd take a picture when it's full in case I ever sell this place. I can show this picture. It's got a pond on it, and I'll have a good full picture with grass around it. So that's why I snapped that picture. This is a movie about what? Buddy sleeping in the morning. I think I might have posted that one, but I'm not sure. That's my earning the hate. That was that rescue that was a freaking just a oh. Can you imagine? You're going to invite me over to help and work. And when I go, do you have a round pin I can use to work with this horse? They go, yeah. And when I get there, I go, where's the round pin? And they show me this. Are you freaking kidding me? And then people are telling me I'm mean because I wouldn't go work there. Freaking people, I swear. Well, that was the thumbnail for, we call it a clue, when the donkey attacked Lester. That's really a pretty good picture. But I don't need that now. I can delete that and clear up my... That's me when Buddy was a baby. I think he was maybe two there. And I was kind of like doing a little sacking out, kind of getting him used to me climbing over him and under him. And he, you can tell his ears are like, dude, what's this crazy human doing? You're supposed to be my buddy. But anyway. This, speaking of this picture, this is kind of funny. So this little pond back here, this woman had, maybe this was a second pond. Maybe this might have been just standing water. But where he was at, this was his owner. This is when his owner still owned him. He wasn't my horse. I would go over there and do his feet and just play with him, and I was riding that other stallion, whatever. So there was a little pond out here, and this woman that owned Buddy, she only likes mares, and she doesn't like when I ride her mares and let them buck because she doesn't like them to buck because when they buck with me, I just kind of laugh because I put them in a halter, no bit, whatever. So anyway, so she has a pond on her place, and in the middle of this pond, it's kind of like a moat. There's a little bitty hill in the middle, and it's got some trees and flowers, and there's a little moat area around it that her horses never go through because they don't like water. So she had this little area that was really neat that she didn't go to, the horses didn't go to, and it was this like pristine little grassy area, in the middle of her little moat pond. Well, I end up moving Buddy here, or Mr. T here, when the other place that I had him at was shutting down or being closed down or environmental, some shit. So I end up moving Mr. T over here. Now, remember, picture this. This woman, her horses don't like water. They don't go through water. She has this night moat, and it's like, it took Mr. T about, I don't know, maybe 2 hours or a day to say, why aren't you guys eating this green grass in the middle of this freaking moat? So he walks in the moat, and he's out there grazing. Well, guess what happens? All of her horses like, shit, we never knew we'd go out there. So they followed Mr. T, and he gave her horses all bad habits now. Her horses never went out there, and it was pretty. And ever since my mean horse, Mr. T, came, he taught them how to go through the water, and now they go through there and eat the grass, and now it's not pretty anymore because of Mr. T. And I'm just like, really? You're going to blame my horse because your horses weren't smart enough, or because you probably beat them, or because you... Now, remember, when she would ride her horse, they wouldn't go through water. I'd ride Mr. T, and they wouldn't go through water. And then I'd get on her horse, and I'd ride them through water, and they were like, well, she just likes you because she doesn't like water when I'm riding her. Oh, okay. It's because she doesn't like water when you're riding her. That's the ticket. Damn. I had it wrong. Once again, I was wrong. I'm always wrong when I try to tell other people about their horses. I don't get it. So this is where they stole my freaking pictures on the Think Like a Horse page on Instagram. And it's fake. She took all my pictures and all my videos, and she's like running around acting like me, answering questions. And I kept that in case we ever end up in court. So that's why that's still there. And that's the pictures I just took. I delete those now. I don't need them. I don't need any more pictures on my damn desktop than I need. Let me delete that one. Okay. Somebody made from old farm equipment. I thought this was a good looking horse. How they made the mane, and they welded all this and made the tail. Man, I would love to have that. That looks like some sort of lift spring. I don't know much about cars. Guys who are into cars probably know what all these parts are. But, I mean, there is some good detail in this freaking horse. I don't know what she used to create this. I can't really make it out whether that's chain. But look at the detail on this horse's head. I thought this was a great piece. I mean, I would love to have this. I bet you she would ask, or he would ask, or whoever made it, probably he. Rick, why can't a woman be? I'm just saying, it's probably a guy that welded it. It could have been a woman. The odds are it's probably a guy, but whatever. I bet you this thing could sell for $3,000 to $5,000. If not, maybe $10,000 or $15,000. I just thought that was a really nice piece of art. I was going to add that to the website. I need to add this to my joke page on my website because we play horseshoes and horses play human shoes. I thought that was kind of a cute photo. So I need to add that to my site. I better take that off in case somebody's kid gets offended. So that was Buddy trying to beg for treats from a FedEx dude. That was a video. I actually posted that. I'm pretty sure I already posted that. I can probably delete that. And that's when I was making a video on my gun channel. That was trolling. That was gun channel. This is a picture I think I used for the thumbnail on that video where they were tough on the horses. So I can delete that one now. You know what? Maybe I can put that on my website and say this is too much or something. Maybe I'll keep that one. And that's the boys. That's a movie of the boys eating because I see a little ransom behind them. I don't know what's on it. This is a movie of them coming in. I don't know what's on that one. It says grain after vet. Also, this must be when I gave them some grain after the vet came. I haven't posted that one yet. That's me on Buddy Boy at the ocean. I think that's Bodega Bay. I don't know where Mr. T was. I must have tied him up, or maybe that was a day I didn't bring him or something. Maybe he was out with his little mares that day and I only took Buddy out. That was that ostrich, that fake ostrich. I love this picture. That dude, somebody said it's from a movie. It was a funny movie, but that looks like this at a distance. That was a great deal. I thought that was pretty cool. Anyway, this is a MP4 movie, and I don't know what it's about because it's got the numbers. So I don't know if Buddy took a swim or something, but I haven't posted that yet. That's another movie that I haven't posted yet. I don't know what's in it. Looks like it was raining. That's another movie. I don't know what it says. Buddy Escape. Maybe that's when Buddy either got out or tried to get out again. I don't know if I made that video or not. That's the $100 trillion note. I was making a point. That's what our money's going to be like. And Zimbabwe, they actually printed a $100 trillion note. And I think you could buy maybe a dozen eggs with this money that the government gave you. And people are like, oh, the government's printing money. Good. Oh, the government's giving us free money and stimulus. Oh, great. Oh, we're giving a, we spent $2 trillion in freaking Afghanistan. Oh, great. Wonderful. Yeah, the government's good. We should give them more money. Yeah, we'll raise taxes. Freaking idiots. I finally found my picture. I emailed it to myself. This is the one I had downstairs on that coin. Liberty 1 ounce gold coin. Great freaking picture. This horse just looks freaking amazing to me. The feet. I noticed the feathers. Got some feathers for the drip line. BZ might be the guy that crafted this. I don't know what the CAC and the BZ stands for. Probably explains it. But we were talking about coins last time, and I just thought this was a great looking coin. So I found a picture downstairs and I sent it up here. That was a good lightning strike. I thought it was pretty freaking cool. Man, look at all that freaking power. Look at that disbursement of energy. Woo! Don't point at it. Where is John here? I'm about to point at lightning and see if John will make a video that you shouldn't point at lightning. It'll shock you. Oh, shit. Here's another one. Boone County, Indiana Sheriff's Animal Control Division. This afternoon, dispatcher reports of a horseback riding incident. The horse had two horseshoes between or become stuck together in mid-stride. I need to add this to my site. So this horse is actually running and his horseshoes get hooked and he goes to the ground and slams him and the rider. Another reason not to have horseshoes. Rick, my horse needs horseshoes and I talked to the vet and the farrier and they've got to have them and they're good and they help the horse and they... Shut up with all the stupid shit. Another incident of why horseshoes are bad for freaking horses. They hook together and the horse couldn't run, couldn't have been, fell, slammed hard at a full run. Rider and him probably got freaking slammed. Ain't no telling how. Somehow we got time to take a picture and we didn't have time to take the freaking saddle off the horse. I question that. Let me finish reading this. ZPD sergeant, who was first on scene, kept the horse calm. Thank you to office to deputy duty and the use of his farrier skills. And thanks to DMV, that's vet, DVM, vet Bruce, for emergency evaluation of horse. The rider and horse are both expected to be okay due to the quick response of the above person concerns. They're expected. That don't mean they are okay. So I wanted to put that picture on my horse. See, I got all these freaking projects. That's why people are like, you know, I come here and I do these lives when I could be doing this takes hour. I have to prepare before. I have to log in. I have to do this. And I'm not crying or looking for sympathy. I'm just telling you that it's really irritating when people don't respect my time and want to tie up shit with bullshit and then blame me when I get irritated or pissed off or in a bad mood because I just don't want to deal with this shit. I've got all these things that I could be adding my website and updating, and that takes time. And, you know, I got to cut my grass. I got to take care of the horse. There's things that I put off in order to make videos, and it would just be nice if I didn't have to put up with shit when I did these. Unfortunately, if you do videos, you got to put up with the shit. I'm not looking for the poor Rick and oh, poor Rick. I'm not looking for that shit. I'm just telling you, it's very frustrating. And Lester is going through that now with the negative shit because of the ostrich and all this other shit, that it's just kind of like, damn, at what point do you just cut off comments or do you just stop doing it or do you just move on? And it's sad because I got a lot of great viewers that I enjoy, you know, interacting with. And it, but, you know, good with the bad. Anyway, here we go. What's next? Well, that's a video that you got shot. That's my Ray Charles. When I saw this video on the Saudi Cup, I used this for my live video because I was just looking at this and I'm like, look at this poor horse's eyes. the snap's undone. One snap is undone. But this horse, you know, somebody's going to look at this and go, wow, look how pretty that horse looks in the wet and the veins. And man, look at him. He's running. And I will say, at least the horse has whiskers. Some dumbass didn't trim his whiskers off. But this metal and straps and mouth and eyes, how do you take a beautiful animal and somehow manipulate it into this is beautiful? I just don't get it. I got to do this knife attack. Okay, so that's it. So those are my different things. We were talking about zoonotic disease. All righty, I need a snack. Rick, what are you eating? It's some sort of trail mix with raisins and nuts, and it's kind of the sweet trail mix because it's got the little white kisses in it to get me in a good mood. When I'm in a bad mood, I look at the little white kissy, and I go, "Oh, it's a little kissy," and I eat it, and I feel better. All right. So, since I didn't have anything planned, and I went through the pictures, and I'm coming up on 2 hours, I'll take questions. So let's. Yeah, I didn't like that picture either. But there's a lot of people that will defend it. Not all horse racing is that way, Rick. I don't use a big bit like that. I have soft hands. I use the feel good, happy bit. I don't use the, what they call that damn band that locks down a horse's nose. I need a snack to help with a hangover. If I had a hangover, I wouldn't be eating this. Hangover food is normally pizza, burger, something greasy to kind of coat the stomach to slow down the alcohol absorption that you drink. So when you have a hangover, you want to eat, you don't want to eat like a salad because the lettuce and that stuff doesn't absorb the alcohol and doesn't give you that coating that something kind of greasy will. No spicy today. Somebody sent me something downstairs. I don't know if I'm going to eat it or not. It's like, take this challenge. It's 5 pieces and nobody's ever been able to eat them. And you need to take the challenge. And I like hype food, but I don't like to eat something just to burn my lips off. So I don't know if I'm going to eat that or not. I meant to bring it up. It's downstairs. I could run down and get it. I got coffee, so I'm going to do it downstairs. Yeah, I agree. Greasy food is better when you got a hangover. It helps. What is everybody else eating? McDonald's is hangover food. Any fast food joint is hangover food. You get bread, you get meat, greasy, french fries, all that shit coats your belly. Is Buddy still looking to escape? Not so much. He kind of got over that. He's still a little sneaker because he still remembers and was still, I catch him every once in a while checking it out. He'll just go over and stand right where he got out and he'll look like, man, I could have been out there before this damn fence came up. But he's not like, for a while there, every time he walked in that pasture, he made a beeline to check it. I mean, it was like routine. But now it's kind of like I'm grazing. Oh, shit, that's where I got out. Let me walk over there and just check it out. So it's getting less and less. And that's why you don't want your horse to get out. You don't want your horse to jump a fence. You don't want your horse to pick up bad habits to buck you off. Every time they do that, it reinforces it in their long term and they remember it. So if you can stop it on the first time he got out, man, I was like, we're not going to stop. I shut that pasture off and they weren't allowed out there. So he only got out once and that's it. So in that one time, he learned it took a week or two for him to stop going over there and checking every day. And he was locked out of that pasture for, I'm going to say 2 or 3 days because the bees were there and they were still working and all that shit. So I kept him out for 2 or 3 days to put some time between his escape. You know what? It didn't matter. When he went in, as soon as I opened that gate, it was a beeline to that freaking gate where he got out. I mean, they remember. And I don't want them remembering. All right. Rick, have you had a chance to review Trainer? Nope, haven't heard of him. First time I heard of him right here. I used to banana popsicle when I had a hangover. Really? I love banana. Like a frozen banana? Is that a banana popsicle? Oh, you're talking like a popsicle banana flavor. I like them. Walmart used to have the big yellow bags of those. And those are great. But I also like the frozen bananas that's rolled in chocolate with the nuts. Oh, man, those suckers are good. Ooh, doggies. We're getting on food. So much for horses. We're back to food. Hang on. Take the challenge. Yeah, I don't know. That shit looked pretty hot. When they start warning and saying you can make sure you have 911 available and shit, I'm like, really? I want to eat something that I got to have my phone and 911 available? I think I'm going to have some cheese on toast. That sounds pretty good. What do I like on toast? Peanut butter is kind of good on toast. Spread a thin layer, kind of melts. Kind of oily. That'll help. Peanut butter and banana is really good. Slice of banana on top of peanut butter, that's pretty good. When I was a kid, we used to take just plain bread, not even toast, and spread butter on it, and then take sugar and sprinkle sugar over it. And that was our treat. So it was a piece of bread with butter and sprinkled sugar on top, and then you eat it. That's pretty good, especially when you're hungry. I like hot food when it's not painful. I like spicy food. I mean, I like when my nose runs and I'm like, whoo, man, and I got to drink something. So I like spicy food. But damaging, killing your taste buds, like on a, I hate when I drop a damn nut because I just had to come up here with a paint scraper because I dropped a freaking cranberry and I ran over it with this, with one of the wheels, and it mashed it flat on this wood floor. And that shit dried because I didn't know it. And I tried to get that shit off with everything. And it wouldn't come off. I had to go get a freaking paint putty scraper and literally scrape it off my wood floor. One freaking cranberry. And I was like, dude, I ain't dropping one of those again. That was a pain in the ass. So now when I drop something, I want to pick it up. All right. What's your opinion on using gel half pads for shock absorption? You know, the gel pad is something I really don't have a lot of experience with, and I haven't used it. It sounds like a good idea if some company wanted to send me some gel pads and I would test it. But, I mean, really the only way to test it correctly would be to put pressure sensors underneath a regular pad and a gel pad and then have the same person ride the same way and do the same thing and then look at the evidence on what the pressure sensors picked up. And they've got little sensors that will tell you. You know, I think they have them when you do compressions on the chest compressions, you're learning CPR. They actually have little sensors that tell you too much, you broke a bone, not enough, et cetera. So, I mean, there's plenty of ways to test something like this. I don't have the materials or the ability and the resources to do it, but it sounds like a good idea because I know when I put gel inserts in my shoes, feels pretty good. But is it better than a good memory foam or whatever? I don't know. I would love, I see these colleges getting grants and doing these studies. I would love to give them some ideas on some studies. I would love them to do that pressure test on bareback and riding with only a pad and then riding with an English saddle and then riding with a Western saddle and the difference between the pressures and then riding with a small person, a light person, and a heavy person and do those same tests. And how much does it change? And maybe put pressures on a horse's hooves, pressure sensors, and have the horse walk around and see how much pressure he has. And then throw a saddle on it and see how much pressure he has. And then put a rider on him and see how much the pressure changes on the hoof. I mean, if you gave me grant money to come up with freaking studies on horses, there would be a lot of shit out there. And that one study that I have on my site about the water hose was a great study. Whoever did that was fantastic. And I've talked about it a few times, but I think it's just a really good study. They put people on horses, had a guy stand there with a fire hose, had their heart rate and the horse's heart rate monitored. And they told the person, when you drive by the fire hose, he's going to squirt you with a wire hose, so be ready. And as they went by, every time the human's heart rate went up, the horse's heart rate went up. Horse didn't know about the water hose. The horse didn't understand he was going to get squirted. Horse didn't have a clue. Only the rider knew. So why was the horse heart rate going up? And that's why they determine it goes up and down. The horse feels you. Not only was a human's heart rate going up, she was getting tense. Her back stiffed up. Her legs got stiff. She probably tightened her hands on her grips. She was getting ready. And the horse was like, why is my owner doing this? Every time she does this, something bad happens. Something bad must be happening because our fear is transferred to our horse. I thought that was a great freaking study, and it proved it perfectly. Every time they went by, both rider and horse heart rate went up. And nobody ever got squirted. All right. Bootlicker, what? Isn't a band, oh, yeah, flash. That might be what it's called. Where they put that band on the nose. Might be a flash. See, I'll just eat subconsciously. I wanted a little snack, but if I don't put these away, I'll just keep eating. Potato salad. Potato salad's good. I like a little dill pickle. I like mustard potato salad with like dill pickles or pickles in it. I mean a tuna sandwich. I ain't had a tuna sandwich in a while. I got some tuna fish down there, but I don't keep mayonnaise in the house. So you can't make a tuna sandwich without mayonnaise. I guess I could make a mustard tuna salad. I've never had that. I got pickles and mustard. Bacon and eggs. That's a good standard. That's a good standby. The bacon's greasy. The egg's good. Protein. Key lime yogurt here. I got some key lime yogurt. You know what? I start eating my yogurt. I take a spoonful before I put my spoon in my yogurt, so it's clean. I just take a spoonful of crunchy peanut butter, and I stir it into my yogurt. And it's really good with the coconut yogurt. Key lime yogurt, it's okay, but it's not as good with the coconut yogurt. And I don't put it in strawberry yogurt. I buy the things at Sam's, and it's got key lime, strawberry, and coconut. And so I like the peanut butter and the coconut, though. I tried some honey in it. It was okay. I put a spoonful of honey in it once, and I was like, eh, it's all right. What's really good is I had a Butterfinger one time, and I hit it and mashed it up and then sprinkled a Butterfinger in a yogurt. Oh, shit, that was really good. Took away all the good shit from the freaking yogurt with the Butterfinger. Blueberry Pop-Tarts. I got some strawberry Pop-Tarts down there. You know, I haven't seen Stewie this morning. I'm a little concerned. Usually I see him every morning, but yesterday I didn't see him and I found him later. But normally he comes up hopping around. He's pretty cute. And since I found that owl stuff, I'm like, I hope he didn't get snagged up. Any barn witch specials in October? I do during October when it, well, normally I don't go out now. Like I said, I just don't go out. If I go shopping, I time it to where it's either early morning, late at night, nobody's around, etc. But I used to, during Halloween, I'd always look for a good witch that would make a good barn witch, a nice witch on a broom or whatever. So I haven't really checked Amazon to see if they have one. Warm bread and milk. Yeah, that's pretty good. But you got to sprinkle. What's really good is cornbread and milk. Man, we call it kush-kush and milk. My grandmother used to take some cornbread, stick it in a microwave, warm it up, then put it in a bowl, pour some milk over it, and sprinkle some sugar over that. It's called kush-kush and milk. Oh, shit, that's good. Woo, doggies. I haven't thought of that or had that in your shit, I might need to go make some cornbread. That shit used to be a great. I don't have milk, though, so shit, I just don't keep milk because it goes bad. Anyone been watching the whole time? Do you know if he saw my comment about Lester's new video, Not Carl Again? I did not see your comment, and I did not see the video. What happened with Carl? What happened with Buddy? Why are we laughing at Buddy? I must be behind. I don't know what's going on. I'm lost. People have done the challenge. Oh, they have? Have they done it online? Has anybody died or had to go to the hospital? I eat Belgium Fritz with mayonnaise. I thought, when I first saw this, I thought, I read bologna. I don't know why bologna popped into my head, because I haven't eaten bologna in 20 years. But bologna was a staple as a kid. It was the cheapest meat. And we had meat in the refrigerator. It was a bologna. And Man, you take a piece of bologna and cut the edges so it doesn't curl up in a ball, and then fry that on both sides. That makes a good sandwich, man. It's almost like a cheap man's bacon. If you want a BLT, you got bologna and lettuce and maybe a tomato, little mayonnaise. That's a good sandwich. I haven't had a fried bologna sandwich in years. Matter of fact, I saw a fried bologna sandwich in that movie. Well, on Longmire, if you watch the series Longmire, that one crazy dude that lives out of the farm was cooking fried bologna. And then, man, when I saw that movie, I was like, shit, I haven't had that or seen that in years. I wonder if they even got, if they show that on freaking fried bologna. Fried B-O-L-O-G-N-A. Is that what it is? Oh, shit, I have bolo. Fried bologna. B-O-L-O-G-N-A? N-A? Fingers aren't right. Is that bologna? Bologna? Yeah, maybe that's it. Bologna. Bologna. There it is. Where's some images? Yeah, that's what it looks like. See, he didn't cut the corners. If you put a little slice, we used to always put four slices on a corner. They don't curl up like that. See, here's one with four slices. You cut it like that, it stays flat. It won't curl up. And there you go. There's a little lettuce, tomato, and bologna. That's a poor man's BLT. Bacon's expensive. Bologna ain't. There's the four corners. Damn! Is that bologna? Double fried bologna and bacon sandwich with cheese. Holy shit. I think my heart just had a little heart attack looking at that. Holy shit. Damn, that does look good, though. I'd have to have a bite of that bad boy. That looks like good bologna and egg and cheese. Oh, see, here's a guy showing how to cut it. Somebody got a little mustard smiley face. Oh, somebody got a little frowny face. Oh, she's in a bad mood. Oh. All righty. All right. Let's get back to comments here. I'm not hungry or into food right now, which is very unusual. Yeah, you know, when you're sick and you probably have a fever, because they say you feed a fever or you starve a fever and feed a cold. So if you starve a fever, normally when you have a fever, a fever is your body's reaction to, it heats up your normal body temperature to kill the virus, because the virus survives in our normal body temperature. So if your body temperature changes, the virus isn't at home, so it doesn't reproduce as well. So when your body gets a fever, it's because it's fighting a virus, it's trying to kill it off and slow it down. And that's why it comes and goes away. As the virus gets stronger and gets bigger, your body says, oh, I better turn up the heat to try and kill some of these guys, etc. I don't think it thinks that way, but that's the theory. So if you're not hungry, you probably are running temperature. Or you may just be, you know, internally not feeling well, but I'm not sure I agree with that. Okay. Because the problem with this statement is you'll have a lot of people who think their saddle is fitted or think, cause I've heard the same thing about a good saddle. You don't need a pad. And I just don't agree with that. A pad is the first protection and first part of cushion and padding between the saddle and the horse. So this shit about a blanket works just as good as a pad, or if I got a good saddle, I only need a sheet, or I only need a blanket, or you don't need a thick pad. I don't believe all that. That we can agree to disagree. You can ride a horse the way you want. I'm just telling you, I disagree with that. I think a good pad is important. Now, the other side of that is putting four pads on top of the saddle is not good, because now the saddle that has a shape of the horse is lost because you have four thick pads. And now you're just setting it like it's flat on the ground. So the saddle doesn't fit at all, and you're more likely to spin because your saddle hasn't been able to conform around the saddle and the horse. So, all right. Have a great peep off to work. Have a good day at work. Don't catch COVID. Morning, y'all. Winter Haven, California. Morning. Lay you sick with COVID? Yes, yes. Rick has mentioned Lester several times. I has stupid human moment. My horse got out. Thank goodness he was okay. Yeah, horses get out. Even, you know, they're masters. All right. Oh, hang on. My freaking comments just shot past like 50. Damn. Hide current comment. What? Where the hell was I? Oh, shit. I lost all those comments. Sorry, people. I got to start over. Sometimes I call a saddle pad a saddle blanket because some people at my barn. What? I see some genius horse training saying my saddle was professionally fitted. So she was riding an English saddle with no pad. Ignorant. Ignorant. Thanks, Riss. Was talking about English European saddles, which have a lot of padding on a saddle called flocking, which is changed by the saddler to fit the horse. Okay, so it sounds like what you're saying, if I get this right, is I know English saddles, sometimes they're very puffy or puffy underneath. And on Western saddles, they have a layer which is even across the whole saddle of normally sheepskin. Sometimes it's fake sheepskin. Sometimes it's real. If you want to pay for good money, you get real sheepskin. And it usually lasts more than the fake. It wears better. So we use sheepskin on a flat surface with the saddle. So there's not much protection between the actual leather of the saddle and the tree. Because in a saddle, you have a wooden tree. Now they have synthetic trees. And then you have leather wrapped around it. So it's still hard. I mean, leather gives a little cushioning for the wood. Then you have the sheepskin, which gives a little cushioning to the leather, which gives a little cushioning to the wood. And then you have the pad. And that's your protection from the saddle on the horse's back. Hang on, my comments just shot by me here. How often do you clean your saddle? Well, it depends on what cleaning is. Depends on what riding is. If I'm riding and we go and he rolls in the mud, or we go through or we're running and we run through mud, there's mud stuck on it, then I would clean it immediately. Clean mud off, you let it dry, and then kind of use a brush and brush it off is the best way to clean it. But I condition my saddle anytime the saddle loses its flexibility and mobility, it starts curling, it looks dry, or I haven't cleaned it in a while. I would probably say once a year, if I'm not using it. If I'm using it, maybe two or three times a year. And again, what is cleaning your saddle? Cleaning can be wiping it down, maybe spraying a little top oil on it, being that. Giving it a good oil and cleaning, maybe scrubbing it with a sponge and saddle soap along all your leather and getting it lathered up, then clean that, and then putting a good coat of oil on every piece of leather and every connection of leather. A lot of people just do the leather they can see, and they don't do the leather where it connects and it holds. And that's the part that dries and cracks and rips out. So when you oil your saddle, you need to get under all the crevices and everywhere. When you clean it, you need to get under there. And that way you keep the leather pieces good in conditions. And then it's less likely to crack and rot and tear off. It's stronger when it's good and oiled like skin, as it is, leather skin. Let's see. I love cowboy movies as a kid. Do you have saddle fitters? Man, you have anything in the horse world now. I mean, I just, you know, to me, how I fit a saddle, and I don't even care if the saddle fits, to be honest. If you got a nice pad and a saddle is kind of made for the horse, you're going to be okay. Unless you're out there riding 8 hours a day or you're trucking up and down hills for 6 hours chasing cattle, saddle fit is not really that important. People make saddle fit this huge deal, and I just don't. If your saddle is causing pain or dry spots on your horse, then you have issues. A dry spot is normally where your saddle has a high point or a pressure point, and it presses so hard onto the horse and skin that when you take the saddle pad off, he's sweating everywhere except right here on this one spot. You have a saddle issue there. Your saddle and your pad, you're getting an extreme amount of pressure there because the skin's not even allowed to sweat because there's so much pressure on it. So I don't like dry spots when I take, I like even sweat marks on my horse when I take my saddle off. But when you put a saddle on, again, unless you're doing a whole bunch of riding, if you got a decent, good pad, I like a 3/4 inch. I guess an inch is okay. I think mine are 3/4, maybe they're an inch, but the ones I have, I like. I've seen thinner. I don't like them thinner. If they're thinner, I'll put two. But my 3/4, I never have put two. If I have a half inch, maybe I'll put a half inch and a blanket. But I usually want at least probably about 3/4 of padding between my saddle and my horse. And then the saddle, you know, they say to fit a saddle, throw a saddle on a horse. And if it doesn't fall off, it fits fine. Okay. Because it's supposed to push on the shoulder. So you throw it on a horse with no pad, no nothing. And you see how it sits. If it's roundy and floppy and it doesn't fit the shape of the horse at all, then it's probably not a good fit. But is that going to hurt you? No, it's not going to hurt you or the horse. If you've got a good pad and your saddle doesn't fit, as long as it's strapped on correctly, you're not cutting a horse in half to compensate. Because when a saddle doesn't fit, you have to make the cinch tighter. If my saddle fits, like Buddy, it fits him because he's got high shoulders, he's big, it's less likely to roll around, so I don't have to put the saddle on. I can actually get on my horse when the cinch isn't even. Some people will tell you that's good. You should be able to get on your horse with your saddle without it being cinched. And then you know your saddle fits good. Well, I mean, that's kind of true, but the worse fitting your saddle is, the tighter you got to do the cinch. The tighter you're cinching up, the more restriction of blood, the tighter it's going to be on the horse, the more uncomfortable it is, and probably the more likely your thing's going to spin. Because if you're going that tight, the saddle's probably already spinning, and that's why you're tightening it up trying to stop that. So, you know, a proper fitting saddle is one that sits on a horse well and it doesn't create dry spots or cause pressure points. I mean, you can put your hand underneath your saddle pad, have somebody sit on your saddle and put your hand in different spots. Have them sit on it and maybe stand up, move your hand. Have them sit on it, stand up, move your hand. You're going to feel the different pressure points underneath that saddle as they put weight on it with your hand next to the horse. So you'll be feeling what the horse is feeling without a pad and just your hand. Then put a pad on there and do the same exercise. Put your hand under the pad and have them sit on it. And you're not going to feel it. It's going to disperse it across your hand. You're going to feel pressure, but you're not going to feel probably pain pressure. And then and you can feel where there's pressure points and you can figure that out. Sliced bologna. I'm going to try that this week. How often do you feed your horses? Another one of those questions. Is there an answer to that? Come on, people. Oh, I guess I'm waiting for a response. So this is one of those questions where you can't answer it without more information. How old is your horse? Does your horse have good teeth? Does he have problem eating? Are you giving him grain? What are you feeding him? Are you feeding him a good rich alfalfa? Or are you feeding him dead cheapest hay you can buy? Does he have pasture? Is he in a dirt lot? Is he kept in a stall? Is he roaming? Is he grazing all day? Is he not grazing all day? Rick, she just asked you one question. You didn't even answer it. Well, no shit. That's why I didn't answer it. That's why I want people to stop asking questions on the internet, because these people who are giving you the answers and trying to be smart is probably giving you shit advice. I mean, it was very easy for him to say, to feed a horse, very simple calculation, feed him twice a day and keep it in a routine and don't feed him too much and he'll be fine. Wow, man, you're really smart. That's a good answer. That's a shit answer. I don't know anything about the horse. I don't know the age. I don't know if it's in a growing, if it's old, if it's, I don't know anything about the horse. When was it wormed? I mean, I know nothing about the horse. How the hell can I tell you how to feed your horse? I can if I just want to be smart, but if I want to tell you what you need to know, this question should not be asked, and anybody that answers it should not be believed. Back in the saddle again. I love mushrooms. I like mushrooms on my steak. And when I cook my mushrooms, I usually slice them up. I throw some garlic and butter in there. Get the butter kind of not, you don't want to burn the garlic, so you don't want to turn the heat up too high. Just kind of get the butter good and warm to where it's sizzling a little bit and the crushed garlic kind of starts sizzling around. And then I'll add a little bit of red wine. And I think there was one other thing, you know, maybe a little salt and pepper, but and then just let them steam a little bit, not steam, but kind of simmer. And then they'll get nice and soft. And then, man, they taste good when they come out. Ooh, doggies. I love some good mushrooms on the. Great, now I'm starving for burger. I haven't had a burger in freaking, you know, the last burger I had was probably a year ago, and it was a protein burger from In-N-Out. And their protein burger is wrapped in lettuce. I wonder if they have that up here. In-N-Out protein burger. Oh, protein style. That's how you order protein style. So this is how they do their burger. If you order protein style, you don't get the bread. They wrap it in lettuce. So this is a double-double. You have two patties. This might be a triple. But you get two patties with cheese, and then if you want the sauce and the tomatoes and everything, and then they wrap it in lettuce. So it's a burger without bread, and they call it protein style. And that's the way I usually get mine at In-N-Out Burger, is I order the protein style. And I always get the grilled onions instead of the whole onions. You know, they chop up and they grill the onions. So that's protein style burger at In-N-Out Burger. And that's, I kind of like those. The thing I don't like about In-N-Out is they never freaking cook their meat. Okay, here's a pro tip for people about beef and raw shit. Okay? Because a lot of guys call me kind of a pussy because I don't eat my hamburgers rare. When you're cooking ground beef, it needs to be well done unless you just ground a steak up and you make the beef right then. Then you can eat it rare, medium rare, pink, whatever. The burgers that you buy in restaurants should never be undercooked or pink or red or raw, because as soon as you ground up a piece of meat, bacteria and oxygen gets to all those parts and it starts growing, even though they freeze it, etc. Because it wasn't cooked, and because it's being cooked fresh, but it's not like a fresh steak or fresh ground beef, that oxygen and bacteria is in there. And the only way to get rid of it is to cook a burger well done. It has to be heated up to kill that bacteria. So I get shit all the time. People are, oh, I'm a burger rare or whatever. And In-N-Out Burger, they are the freaking worst. I hate them. I order it extra well done and it comes out pink. They cannot make a well-done burger at that freaking place. Half the time their burgers are raw. It's very dangerous. It's not good to eat raw ground beef unless you ground it up. When you ground it up, it's not stored. It's not kept. Oxygen and bacteria doesn't start to grow. And therefore, you can cook it like you would a steak, like you can cook a steak medium rare. When you get a steak, even medium rare, it's browned and heated on both sides to kill the bacteria and oxygen attacking the meat on the outside. Where oxygen gets to, it is browned and heated. And then you can eat the raw in the middle because it hasn't had the bacteria. When you ground beef, make a patty, and then freeze it, and then cook it later raw, you are asking to get food poisoning. Now, you can call me full of shit. You can tell me I'm wrong. I'm telling you, there's science behind this, and you should never be eating a burger that's not well done at places unless they ground their ground beef there fresh. All right? Rick, you don't know what you're talking about. I've been eating burgers. I've never. All right, whatever. You can eat your burger any way you want. I don't give a shit. I'm just telling you. Rick, your new video on the Dr. Crook's cross under bitless bread. Hey, Rick, what's your view on the Dr. Cook's cross under? I think that's the one. I think I did a video on that. Dr. Cook's cross over bitless. Let's try that. Shop Dr. Cook crossover bitless. Oh, these are all ads up here. I'm looking for a decent freaking picture. Let's see how this picture comes out. Okay. So when we're talking about the crossover bit, and I have done this before, and to me, this is a gimmick. It's unnecessary, and I'm not a fan of it. So you want my opinion? I just gave it to you. Now I'll tell you why. First of all, whoever put this freaking chin straps on, the idiot, because it's supposed to be underneath the freaking chin, and it's over his freaking cheeks. So I don't know if this is what this crossover is connected to, but this is supposed to be what they call a throat latch, and it's supposed to be by the throat, not down the freaking face. But maybe that's part of the design. I don't know. I thought a crossover occurred in this area right here where this rein goes to the other side and connects to this, and this rein goes through a ring on the other side and it connects over here. So what it's doing is it's causing... Shit. It's causing a crossover underneath. So when I pull on my right rein, this is wrapping around the horse's nose and actually pulling his head from the opposite side like a bit. It's called bitless. When I pull on this rein over here, the horse is getting pressure here, and he follows his head, and he turns. If I have a crossover bit, I'm pulling over here, and he's getting the pressure over here. To me, that's confusing. That's not normal. You're changing what you do to a horse from on the ground when you're leading him with a halter and a lead rope to where he always gets his control here. He follows his head. He gives to pressure. He moves normally. And now you want to use the crossover bit. And when I pull, I'm pulling on the opposite side of the face and forcing his head this way. I'm not a fan of it. To me, it's just another gimmick to confuse some bullshit when it should be, you know what? If I use a rope halter underneath here, when I pull this side, he comes here. When I pull this side, he comes here. He always gets the same direction from the same point. I'm not even a fan of the little clips on the side that you see here. I'm not even a fan of those. People are like, well, I went bitless, but I don't feel comfortable when it's underneath, so I've got mine hooked on the side so I can pull them. People have a mindset from bits that I have to be able to pull at the side I'm on, and they don't understand that I lead my horse day in and day out by his chin on a lead rope and halter, and I tie him and I do everything. And for some reason, there's this freaking mind block that nobody wants to get over. Why do you want to change something that works on the ground just because you get on his back? It doesn't matter. I just don't. So that's my, I'm not saying it's bad or it's evil or, sorry, Mr. T. I'm not saying all that. All I'm saying is that's why I don't like it. And that's why I'm not a fan of it. You can ride and use what you want. All right, let me go back to my questions here because I got lost here. Shit, that question's gone. Damn, sorry. I'm going to go down to new comments. Too many shot by. I didn't get the fried egg on the burger thing. I love a fried egg on a burger. I learned that in Korea. When you order something in Korea, a burger, there's a lady, a little old lady. We go out and get drunk at night. We're coming back. All the drunk GIs are coming back to the base because there's a curfew. When I was there, there was a curfew at midnight. A siren sounded. If you were on the road, you went to jail, you were arrested. So there was a curfew. So at like 11:15, they give a warning siren saying, you better get your ass back to base or you better get in with somebody. Because once you're on the road, nobody's on the road at night. So there's this one lady that set up a little stop and somebody from the States, because they didn't have a McDonald's there when I was there. I was there in 78 and 77 and 81 is when I was in Korea. So they didn't have McDonald's there or anything. So somebody sent them a McDonald's hat and a McDonald's little styrofoam. That's when McDonald's used to use the styrofoam things for the burgers. And so she had one of those on her little cart that she wheeled out there, and she made burgers. But her burgers were freaking badass. She put cucumbers on it, sliced cucumbers. She'd fry the burger up in front of you. She'd throw some veggies in the grease with the burger and fry them up and throw them on a burger. And then she would throw an egg that she cooked in the grease from a burger and flip the egg and then put that on top and put a throw a sliced piece of cucumber in the grill in the grease, kind of make it kind of flimsy a little bit, and then lay that sliced cucumber on it, and it gave you a burger. Dude, when you drunk, that burger was, man, it was great. So that's when I first got introduced to egg on a burger. An egg on a burger is pretty good. But I also put crushed red pepper on my burger, and a lot of people think that's crazy. I'd put crushed red pepper on any meat I eat, whether it's bacon, a burger, it doesn't matter. I think it tastes better with crushed red pepper. I like the spiciness. So put a fried egg on it. All right. Same in Germany with fried egg on burger. They do it or they don't do it. Rick, are you a fan of Portorella? What the hell is that? How do I know if I'm a fan of something when I don't even know what the hell it is? What is it? P-O-R-T-I-L. Is it two L's? L-L-O-S. Oh, it must be a burger joint. Never been there. Didn't even know it was a burger joint. I thought it was some sort of horse contraption. Damn, that looks like a nice hot dog. Oh, man, look at that pickled tomato. Dude, that looks good. Jalapeno? Shit, I'm there. Damn, that looks freaking scrumptious. That looks like a nice, like a poor boy chopped up steak. That's pretty freaking good. That looks good. Damn, where has this place been all my life? What the hell? Look at those jalapenos on there with green peppers. Dude, that's like my dream sandwich. Where the hell has this place been? Why ain't I never? I bet they ain't got one of these in Texas. Damn. Oh, man. Those jalapenos be looking freaking good. Woo, doggies. That looks like maybe like a grilled green bell pepper. That looks good, too. The hell, they got one of these in Texas? In Texas. All locations. I don't see Texas. Florida, California, Illinois. Damn! Indiana. Oh, hang on. I ain't got down a T yet. Shit. There ain't none in Texas. I'm about to say that damn place looks good. Shit, I ought to buy that restaurant, open one up in Texas. That shit would be a hit here. I could tell by the food. Wow. Iowa. Damn. That's too, where's this place out of? This place must be out of here. Illinois. It must be out of Illinois. Because they got every damn place in the world. That place. They got freaking locations everywhere. I got to ask my buddy Chucky if he's been to one of those. Because he's riding around a patrol car. He can go anywhere he wants. Damn, that looked good. Shit. That's some good vittles there. Woo, doggies. I'm hungry now. I sprained my left wrist. Because you did something stupid or because you just fell or what? Did your horse trip you? I see Michigan. Time to go make some lunch. Bummer, no Texas. I know. Shit. I'd be all over that place. Did y'all say baked necks? What? Now I want a burger. All right, let's go ahead and look at some good burgers. Best burger. Didn't I already do this before? Damn. 12 best burgers in the world. Looks like it might be some mushrooms, maybe some bacon, some cheddar cheese, maybe some Swiss cheese, a little more bacon. Damn, that looks pretty good. That's lettuce, bacon, tomato. That's a pretty standard burger right there. Toasted bun. That's an American burger for you people out in America. This is kind of what you, if you want a burger at most places, this is what you get. Lettuce, tomato, pickle, a burger with some cheese on a bun. And then you get either mustard or mayonnaise. That's how most of our burgers are here in the U.S. Well, this has got red onion. I like red onion on burger. That's pretty good. It's actually got grilled white onion, too, which is pretty good. And it's got mustard and ketchup. And it's a double with cheese. I didn't see any bacon. But that's a pretty good-looking burger. Those grilled onions always make a burger taste good. That looks like a soft egg on a burger. So... now, this looks like it's going to be a medium well burger, and it looks like it was freshly ground and made. So I don't think this is a frozen burger. You're going to get this at a high-end place. Red onion, lettuce, tomato, cheese, standard burger. Hmm. That's got some bacon. You know what? I mean, bacon's okay, but I got to admit, I'm not a big fan of bacon on a burger. I mean, I don't need it. It's okay, but I'd rather taste my bacon and taste my meat differently. So to put both of them together, it's okay, but I'd rather eat my bacon for breakfast than have a good burger later than eat them both together, personally. What's this one? It's got some red. What is that, beets or paste? Red onions? They made some paste? There's a burger place in California I used to take the motorcycle to. It was freaking, I mean, it was a killer burger. I think it was like $15. But dude, it was, you know, white tablecloth, nice place, have a glass of wine. But their French fries were handmade, cut kind of thin. just freaking a great burger, made fresh, fresh bread that they actually sliced and baked. And I mean, it was, I used to love to go to that place. Okay, so this is a little much for me. I like meat and cheese, but I wouldn't order this burger. Let me put it that way. It looks good, and I'm not saying you're bad if you order it, but I probably wouldn't order that. I would probably order that one. Mushrooms, I'd order that one with some grilled onions and cheese. That's a good-looking little burger. That's a little high-end burger. See how the ground beef, you can tell, has been freshly ground and made into a patty? So this one could probably you could probably get it medium rare. But when I mean a burger, I don't really care if it's well done or not. Just your standard fast food burger. I don't see anything. I see some jalapenos. I love jalapenos on my burger, that's for sure. This is Ireland's best burger. Wow. Ireland, what do they put in Ireland? No, I ain't accepting shit. How about that? Now that's the only picture they show. You ain't selling a burger. How about that? Now, I hate when somebody smashes my bun like that. I mean, I don't mind if I'm doing a bun smashing, but I don't want my burger bun smashed. And that just irritates me. Rick, you're in a bad mood when you get a burger. Shut up. You freaking, that's got a fried egg on it with some cheese, grilled onions, and another piece of beef, a little sesame seeds on top, 2 all beef patty, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun. Yeah. That's got some bacon. I'm not seeing something like really outrageous that I've like never seen. I'm not a big fan of the onion ring kind of thing on a burger. Some people put a fried onion ring, or these are fried onion skins or whatever. I'm not into that. I'd rather eat my French fried grease on the side instead of on the burger. That's a mustard with pickle. I like that. That looks pretty good. That almost looks like it's got some sliced pastrami, seasoned pastrami on a meat. Man, that looks pretty freaking good. Woo, doggies. Yeah. Damn. I don't know what the hell that qualifies burger. This is a thick ass burger. Holy shit. Wow. I like big burgers. Boom, 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 boom. Bun's a little over toasted. I'd be irritated at that. You burnt my damn bun. I like the crisscross fries. That looks like it's got some pastrami on it too. Almost looks like beef jerky. That looks like a damn mess. Hell, that just looks like somebody threw that at somebody. Somebody picked it up. Said, this is my new burger. That's just too much damn bacon. I don't want raw. And I hate floppy, uncooked bacon. I like my bacon cooked. This shit right here, some people don't like it. Their bacon well done. I like my bacon. I don't like it burnt. It can be a little flimsy, but I don't like it flopping around like it just came out of the package. That looks like it's got some avocado in it. Avocado on a burger ain't bad. That looks like a grilled onion ring or something, or maybe an onion ring with cheese. That's some good looking crisscross fries there. Spicy crisscross fries. All right, everybody eating here. Can we get back to, what time is it? 2:35. All right, we got to end this sucker, people. Stop. I love pastrami, my favorite lunch meat. I was looking up what pastrami was. I used to think it was pork, and I think it's beef. I think it's like seasoned beef, isn't it? I don't know what pastrami is. It's thin cut beef? I don't know. Shit. Nothing bad. It just hurts. Are we still on your wrist? I cook my bacon in an oven. I like bacon cooked in an oven. I actually did a video to where I haven't posted it yet. I uploaded it, never did it, to where I cook my bacon in the oven and I sprinkle a little brown sugar and crushed red pepper on a bacon after it cooks. And while it's cooking, it cooks into it. Man, that's just good. And when I cook my bacon, I normally just cook the whole pack. if I buy a pack of bacon, because I don't want to leave it, it'll get hit in the refrigerator, I don't see it, whatever. I cook the whole thing, and then I take the cooked pieces out, and I put it in a Ziploc baggie, and I keep it in the refrigerator. And then whenever I want a piece of bacon, I just pull one out that's already cooked, lay it on a napkin, stick it in a microwave, it bubbles up, heats it up, and then I eat it. And then I don't have to worry about pulling out the bacon each time and redoing the grease and messing things up all the time. I cook it all at once, throw away the foil paper with all the grease and oil, and then I put all the cooked stuff in a Ziploc bag in the refrigerator. And when I want it, I pull it out. Sometimes I'm making soup. I'll pull out one of those pieces, and I'll chop up one of the pieces of bacon. I'll drop it in the soup, and then I'll just give me my soup. I like having cooked bacon in the refrigerator. But, I mean, I buy bacon maybe twice a year. So there was a guy who used horse meat for pastrami. Oh, man. That dark bun looks like pumpernickel bread. Oh, maybe it is. Maybe it wasn't burnt. I'm not a big pumpernickel guy. I mean, there's couple restaurants that serve that. It comes out warm. I can have one slice with a little butter, but I don't eat bread and butter when I go out because I fill up on that shit and I want to enjoy my meal. I'd rather get the calories on the shit I really like instead of just snack butter and bread. Thank you for another great live. Thank you for coming. Glad you're here. Hopefully I wasn't too mean to anybody. And I'm glad everybody stopped telling me I was freaking so mad and in a bad mood, because that shit gets old. How would you like to hang around somebody? Why are you in a bad mood? You're in a bad mood. Why are you in a bad mood? Why are you snapping at? Why are you in a bad mood? Who the hell wants to wake up or be around that shit? You can buy bacon cooked. Really? I don't think I've ever seen cooked bacon. And you know what my problem is with that? I don't know who's cooking it. Because when I'm handling bacon and food, I'm kind of clean. So I don't know how they're cooking the bacon. I was watching Gordon Ramsay at a restaurant, and a dude was dumping fried chicken on a plate to serve. One of the pieces fell out on the floor, and the dude picks it up, throws it back in the fryer, shakes it off, and puts it back on a plate. And Gordon goes, "Did you just pick that up off the floor?" He goes, "Yeah." He goes, "But I sanitized it. I put it in the fryer." He goes, "What the?" He goes, "You're going to serve that?" And he goes, "Yeah." He goes, "What the?" He takes off and goes to the owner. "Is this freaking standard?" I love Gordon. And people call me Gordon Ramsay, the horse world. And I think it's a compliment, because I love the way Gordon just gets in people's ass. He don't play around. But he knows what he's talking about, and he's trying to improve people and make them better. So I get him. But a lot of people don't get him, and they hate him, and they think he's mean and rude. But he's freaking funny, man. When that dude picked that piece of chicken up, I mean, I was watching. I was like, "What the fuck? Did he just pick that shit up?" But I was like, "What the?" And then Gordon got in his ass. I was like, "Holy shit!" You never know what you got. I mean, when you go fast food, you just don't know any food. Get better soon. Don't point at the burger. Oh shit! The camera shocked me. Beef brisket, is that what pastrami is? Is brisket? Brisket's beef. Pastrami is beef. Yeah, that's what I thought. I had to look it up though, because for some reason I was thinking it was in the bacon or pork family. There's pastrami. What's that other stuff, that thin meat that they use? Like on crackers to make that biscotti or biscotti, the Italian thingy. The Italian meat that they always serve kind of raw, or it looks raw, thinly sliced. What's that? Prosciutto? Is that what it is? I can't remember. I'm not a big fan of it, whatever it is. Everybody like dies for it. I'm kind of like, eh, it's all right. Friend got crystal meth on McDonald's. Oh, shit. Yeah, prosciutto. That's what I was talking about. Is that how you spell it? I thought it was P-R-O-S-S-I something. I was going to type it up. There, here's what I think it looks more like. There you go. Let's see what that is. P-R-O-S-C-I-U-T-T-O. Yeah, that's what I was looking for. A lot of people, oh, shit. That must have been a damn ad trying to sucker me into some bullshit. Yeah, so it looks like almost like raw bacon, but it's thinly sliced. And I mean, I've had it a couple times, and it was just kind of a little, I don't know. I'm just not a fan of it. What is that? Is that beef or pork? It's pork. Oh, somebody said it's pork. I love Gordon. If you like Gordon, you've got to go on YouTube and look when he's working with his daughter, Tilly. I love her. She is so freaking cute and smart. And gives him so much shit when she's filming, and he's Mr. Perfectionist, and he's telling her, pan down. Tilly, pan down. And she's like, I am. And she's like, pan down, look. And he grabs her arm and shows the food. She goes, I am. And then she goes, I love their interaction. She always does stupid. What did she do to him? Squirted him in the face with something. She got him to do some trick or something, and she squirted him right in the face with either a bottle of Coke or water. It was freaking hilarious because, you know, he's Gordon Ramsay. Most people probably don't play good jokes on him, and she gives him shit. I freaking love her. Her and him make a great little team. She's so sweet. Ham or pork? Well, ham is pork, ain't it? Oh, you're saying it's either ham or pork. Oh, okay. Or porco. Is that pork? With a K, you just use a C? The Ramsay family are nice. They are. I think they, and he's got a dog always running around the kitchen. I love that. When I saw him at home and he had a dog in his kitchen, I was like, dude, I knew I freaking liked you. My ex-wife was a pain to ask about the dog. No, he can't come to the kitchen. He can't come to the kitchen. She went around. That dog was in the kitchen all the time. I love Gordon and Tilly. I do too, man. They are freaking cute. And you could tell they have a good daughter, daddy daughter. I'm thinking that you probably wouldn't want to mess with old Gordon. Oh, I've seen him work with his mother too. He does. Yeah. He's kind of, you know, okay, mom. And he doesn't want to be the expert to his mom. And even though he probably is, and he's probably forgotten more about cooking than his mom knows, he still kind of gives her the mom kind of respect that, hey, you know, you're still mom. Even though I'm smarter than you, and I know I am, I'm not going to tell you or show you. Rick has enemies. Really? I have enemies? How could I have enemies? Everybody loves me. I might have enemies that are hidden and hiding. I don't have too many enemies that confront me face to face. Isn't that funny? I got a lot of enemies that don't confront me face to face. Call that a clue. Let's see. Where are we at here? North Carolina. I haven't had some semi since my brother, mother, grandmother passed. What's semique? What the hell is that? S-I-M-C-E. Sink? What? What is that? Doesn't look like food. I haven't had some S-I-M-C-E since my grandmother passed. What the hell is that? Wow. Okay, I'm lost on that one. Everybody loves Rick. No, everybody don't love me. That's okay. I don't want everybody to love you. I'd rather good, smart, level-headed, secure people like me and have all the insecure, crybaby, wannabe, emotional wreck barn witches hate me. I'm okay with that. Since. Oh, since my grandma. I haven't since my grandma. Okay, shit. I was like, what the hell is he talking about? All right, let's see. Well, good. I'm glad I made your day. Hope webcam chat. Oh, I got some little spammer that came in here. Well, guess what, dude? You just got your ass blocked. See you. Wouldn't want to be you. How did he sneak in at the end here? Do you like Robert Irving? I don't know who that is. How can not anyone love Rick? Oh, it's very easy. Let me count the ways you cannot love Rick. Shit, there should be an encyclopedia of ways not to love Rick. Oh, shit. Did his mom teach him how to cook? I mean, I'm sure she had an influence, but look, you don't get to... I don't know if people understand how hard it is to get a Michelin star restaurant. I mean, it is just freaking damn near impossible. Your restaurant has to be so high and so well rated. And Michelin, the tire people is the one that gives out Michelin stars. Most people don't know that. So the Michelin people that make tires, the Michelin man, they give out Michelin stars. And they started long ago by having their tour guide to encourage people to drive and to use their tires, and they would go around restaurants and they would have maps and they would rate restaurants. And then over time, it moved into they are the gold standard for a restaurant rating. So now the Michelin people will not give out the way, and you can look this up. I mean, on how this works. This is pretty cool. I thought it was great. They don't even tell you what they look for. They give you ideas on what they look for. But they send people in unannounced. You'll never know. They go and eat at your restaurant, and they have this big checklist on things like, did the chef greet you? Were you kept this? Were the place clean? What was your first impression? Blah, 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 blah. Once they get one of their mystery guys, and it's not just anybody they don't pick. These people work for Michelin. They actually give out these stars. So then once you get that good rating, they have to come back, I think, three times and have that good rating with no negative in order for you to be eligible for your first star. And then I think it goes some other thing to get your first star. And the most restaurants, I mean, if you look up how many Michelin star restaurants are, there's not that many. I mean, I bet you there's not 40 stores. Let's look this up, because this is really cool. If you don't understand how hard it is to get a Michelin store, M-I-C-H, Mitch, C-H-L-E-N, tires. I want Michelin star restaurants. Here we go. Michelin star restaurant guide. What makes a Michelin star? Let's see what they say. A Michelin star, to earn a Michelin star, a restaurant needs to be very good restaurant in this category. Oh, bullshit. For two stars, it needs to be excellent. Three stars, must serve exceptional. Okay, I thought you could get four star. Oh, there's a five star. Do any restaurants have five stars? No, it's just four. Following announcement of 2017 Michelin Guide, the restaurant Four Seasons Hotel in Paris have been collectively crowned with a total of five Michelin stars, making it a first luxury hotel in Europe with three Michelin star restaurants. They got three Michelin stars in one place. Dude, if I go to Paris, I'm staying at that. If I live in Paris or by Paris, I'm going to this restaurant. Look, when you go to a Michelin star restaurant, you're looking at probably, I want to say $200 to $500 for lunch and probably $600, $700, $800 for dinner. If you hit a Michelin star restaurant, because I mean, the service is just, it's just amazing. Look into how you get your stars. But anyway, I think Gordon Ramsay has like four different restaurants that has Michelin stars. Four. Most chefs have never even come close in a runoff to get one star. And Gordon has like four or five. I mean, it's crazy. Michelin star restaurants for Gordon. Oh, this just gives one of his restaurants. Michelin star restaurant, star dining. I wonder if both of these have those. Freaking Gordon, man. What's this 580 with a little E? What kind of money is that? I don't know. People, oh, I'm sorry, I don't have it blown up. I don't know what this little E means. 1,000, is that 1,000 euros? I don't know what a euro is compared to a buck. How many Gordon restaurants have Michelin stars? Seven. He's got seven freaking restaurants with a Michelin star. You see, people think, look at him and they go, he's anal and he's a perfectionist and he's too perfect and he doesn't allow people to make mistakes and he's too judgmental and he doesn't make people feel good. And it, you know what? He has freaking standards. How many other people do you think have seven Michelin star restaurants? Let me tell you, zero. He has seven Michelin star restaurants a group worldwide, including flagship restaurant Gordon Ramsay, which has held three Michelin stars for the more than 19 years. Oh, yeah. And once you get a star, you don't keep it. You have to be retested and they come in and make sure that you're maintaining the standard to keep your star. So you don't just get it and then you have it forever. So they'll come back and they'll take it and you only keep it for so long. So you come back and you have a disgruntled employee. When they come back, you lose your Michelin star. See ya. Wouldn't want to be you. I mean, go look and research if you're into good fine dining, because there are people that literally will plan a vacation to hit every Michelin star restaurant in their thing. And I think there's like maybe only 40 or 50 in the U.S. How many Michelin star restaurants in U.S.? A tour of USA, 3 Michelin star. There's only 3? I thought there was more than that. A tour of USA's 3-star Michelin restaurants. No, no, no. I want to know how many total. Michelin star restaurants 2019. So this must have them all, maybe. Man, look at that freaking dessert. Woo, dog. Everything is perfection at a Michelin star restaurant. I mean, it's just freaking amazing. Look at the cleanliness. If you ever get a chance to eat it, I've never eaten at one. If you ever get a chance to eat at a Michelin star restaurant, just spend the money and do it. Because it definitely would be on my bucket list. All right. I got to get the hell out of here. What time is it? Freaking 2:52. I was going to get out of here at 2:30. All right. We're on food. We're not on horses. Why would a tire company be judging restaurants? Because I said that at the beginning. You must have missed it. They wanted to promote, back when they were starting selling tires, they wanted to promote driving and touring and moving around. So they decided to start doing restaurant and rating and grading restaurants to encourage people, and they put out a map of good restaurants. So if you bought Michelin tires, or you supported Michelin, or you want to go, they didn't have websites back then or whatever, but they were kind of got learned to where, hey man, they do a good job on these restaurants. So as they got popularity and they became good at it and they became a reliable source for restaurants, it got transferred into that. All right. You have to go look at it. All right. I got to get out of here. Somebody's going to ride a horse. Go ride your horsey. Have a good ride. I need to do Buddy and Ransom's feet, but you know, again, I probably won't get it done today. Now it's hot. I sat up here when it was cool. I need to cut the grass. I need to put some weed killer on some of the weeds down by the gate. All right. Y'all have a good one. I'm out of here. Thanks for coming. If I upset you, I'm kind of sorry if you didn't deserve it. If you deserved it, I ain't sorry. All right. We'll end it there.